good afternoon, or good night, ladies and gentlemen. Whatever it is where you are now looking at the CFL Grey Cup game of 1995. Today's date is November the 19th, Sunday, 1995. There are the Baltimore CFL Stallions. This is probably their last game as Baltimore Stallions, because the Browns are coming to town. The reason why you have missed some of this game is because I did not have a TV guide, and believe it or not, I watched Baltimore stations. I watched Channel 2, Channel 11, Channel 13, so the Browns aren't even here yet, but they're not even talking about the Stallions. Last year it was like, oh, the game starts, it's on ESPN2, gotta see it, gotta do it. So what happened this year? I heard nothing about the CFL Stallions. They had more coverage of basketball, and we don't even have a team, than they had of the CFL Stallions. So, Jim Speros, even if we did not get the Browns, I hope he still takes the team and leaves, because that's what Baltimore deserves. Because they're like ditching because of the Browns coming, if they even get here. And here they're losers, not even winning this season, but the CFL Stallions actually are in the Super Bowl of the CFL, which is called the Grey Cup. Anyway, enough complaining about Baltimore. Get ready for some CFL Grey Cup action. It may be the last game that Baltimore participates in. Now warping to game zone. It is in the second quarter, so have a good time. Warping to the second quarter.
And that gets them fired up here at Taylor Field as the Stampeder starts riding Wally Buono. His team now leading 13-7. So far, look at the problems. 3 fumbles, 1 interception. Calgary, 4 fumbles. And one interception. That's when they played each other on August 6th. And the fans here, 54,000 in attendance. I would say 53,000 are rooting for Calgary.
At least, because you've got basically the Baltimore players, wives, girlfriends, and grandmothers, and that's about it. Look at these guys. Gus, we saw guys like that every night in the streets this week of Regina.
McLaughlin kicking off from the 35. A drive kick scooped up at the 30-yard line by Chris Wright. Heads up the sidelines and gets wiped out shy of the 50.
You see another situation in the open field with some slippage. And that time, trying to make the cut, Chris Wright, nobody even touched him. He went down.
And with a quick comment, here's our Lisa Bowes.
Thanks, Gus. Obviously, Doug Flutie was in some kind of pain because they just gave him a shot of something, obviously a painkiller, to dull his bruised tailbone. So just want to let you guys know, he just took a shot. Guys?
Well, all the women across the United States concerned about Doug's tailbone.
First down to 10 from the 47. Ham passing on first down to the far side. Complete. This is Robert Drummond, and he'll get down to the 45-yard line, pickup of 20 yards. Now, Drummond, third year out of Syracuse.
A little busted coverage. Coleman takes off for the deep middle of the field. No linebacker replaces. Drummond wide open. He catches the ball as well as a wide receiver. Great speed.
Has 4-4 speed. Spent 3 years with the Philadelphia Eagles. First down from the 45. Ham. Firing. Robert Clark hauls it in, and he gets inside the 25 at the 23-yard line. Defensively, Al Jordan for Calgary.
Two plays in a row where the Calgary defense, A, can't get to Ham, and B, laid way off the receiver. Good throw by Tracy Ham. That's about a 40-yard pass from one hash mark all the way outside the numbers to Clark. Nobody anywhere near him. Kenton Leonard comes in late.
65-yard width of the field. So throwing to the sidelines is always a long throw. First down from the 23. Ham in trouble, gets it off, incomplete. Robert Drummond, the intended receiver.
That was a blitz by inside linebacker Matt Finley, number 37. He only has one sack on the entire season, so that's unlike Calgary. A little changeup. Finley coming on the blitz, and that forced Ham to get rid of the football more quickly than he wanted to.
Finley in his 10th season out of Eastern Michigan, playing in his last football game today.
Unless he can't sell enough stocks, you will see him next year.
A stockbroker during the offseason. Second down and 10 from the 23.
Blitz.
Ham, plenty of time. Underneath, incomplete. Mike Kringle, wide open, bobbles the football and drops it.
That was the rap on Kringle when he first came into the league, that he couldn't catch the football coming out of the backfield. He's pretty much put that to rest. He had 33 catches this year. He's an excellent receiver. I think we've got another busted assignment. Look, nobody anywhere near him. He fights the football. You got advantage of those kinds of opportunities in big games.
Brings on Carlos Huerta, 9 of 14 in the playoffs. This is a 30-yard attempt.
Carlos does not use a tee unless field conditions are horrible.
Good snap, good hold, good kick. And Huerta splits the uprights, and the Stallions now trail 13 to 10, 12:09 left here in the second quarter of play. We've got a three-point ball game as Calgary gets ready to go back on offense. Gus Johnson, Mike Mayock with you. This is the 83rd Grey Cup from Taylor Field in Regina, Saskatchewan. 54,000 crazy fans enjoying a brisk day of football.
You know, Gus,
CFL.
In the 83 years they've had the Cup, this is the first time it's come to Regina, which is about as football crazy as it gets. And the only way I can equate it to people in the States is it's kind of like a Pittsburgh. They love their football, they take it very seriously, but because of the weather considerations, they've never had it here before. The people of Regina did a great job setting the whole week up, taking care of everybody. Look at them, they love it here.
And in terms of the weather, things may get a little uglier. Flurries starting to come down right now as Calgary takes over. First down and 10 from the 35. Play fake, Flutie.
Man to man.
Up top to Sapungis, incomplete. Ball was underthrown to David Sapungis, and he became a defender as Ken Watson almost came up with the interception.
Kenny Watson's been busy early in this game, slightly beat. The ball's underthrown. Now it's a jump ball. Good position by Watson. Sapungis turns into a defender. That's the third knockdown early in the second quarter for Ken Watson.
David Sapungis had 10 receptions for 98 yards when they faced Baltimore at McMahon Stadium. Second down and 10. Screen pass, Sapungis, and he goes nowhere, wrapped up at the 40-yard line. Great-looking tackle by Tracy Gravely.
Tracy Gravely, Charles Anthony did a great job on the recognition. It's a little slip screen underneath. Anthony's man. It's man-to-man. Watch Gravely coming from the right side of your screen. Makes the hit. There's Gravely. Charles Anthony dumps him down.
And that will force the Stampeders to punt.
No, we want to go 2 feet.
Get a little feedback from Doug. I think he said, oh, man.
Tony Martino, third punt of the game, standing at the 26-yard line. Low punt, fielded, bobbled, but Chris Wright jumps on it, and he'll get over the 35 up to the 37-yard line. Flags are on the play.
Looks like another no yards penalty. And because of the type of punting game we're going to have today, I wouldn't be surprised to see a few more of those kind of penalties.
Only a 5-yard return, 35-yard punt. Here's Dave Ewell.
First down.
Remember, 5-yard bubble is the rule. He fumbles it. You've got number 87, Kevin Reed, within the 5 yards. That's why the flag was thrown.
First down from the 43. Here's Ham throwing on first down, stepping up. And Tracy Ham takes it, gets out of bounds at the 50-yard line, and that's what he can do. And Tracy Ham running the football, it'll keep this Calgary defense honest.
I think we're going to get a holding call that will take that back. But Frank Spaziani, the defensive coordinator for Calgary, told me before the game he can handle Mike Pringle. He knows what Pringle brings to the table. He knows what their wide receivers could do. But the guy that scares them is Tracy Ham on the corner.
And there is Wally Buono. The first man you had a chance to take a look at was Don Matthews.
Wally's saying take him back. It's not even a question.
Buono, 1-1 in Grey Cups. The last time he won it in 1992.
Major foul, face mask, Baltimore 64, 15 yards, first down repeat.
That's Mark Dixon, second year right guard out of the University of Virginia. And
here comes Will Johnson. When you're blocking him on pass, look at the right hand right there. No problem with that's a good call by the refs. Dixon all over the face mask. It's so difficult to block Will Johnson when he's going upfield on the pass.
First down and long for the Stallions. They swing it out of the backfield to Pringle. And he gets upended at the 35. Marvin Coleman coming out of his right quarterback position to make the hit.
Marvin Coleman all 5'9", 163 in the open field. He said, hey, I'm going low on this guy. Look at Marvin break on the football, number 17. Oh, look at the block. Drummond on McClanahan. It doesn't get any better than that block right there.
Second down, 17 from the 35. Ham again, firing it downfield for Culver. Incomplete. Skinny Culver had at least two steps on the closest Calgary defender, but Tracy Ham just couldn't put it on him.
Defensive ends Marvin Pope and Will Johnson are starting to get up the field and put pressure on Ham. You know what's interesting, Gus? When you have the wind, sometimes it can be as difficult to throw a long pass with the wind as against it because the ball tends to sail on you.
Josh Miller punting from the 21-yard line. His third punt. Averaged 47.7 yards per punt on the year, but so far his numbers are down, only 35 yards. And he gets off a bomb here, driving Terry Vaughn back to the 20-yard line. Vaughn turning it upfield, and he's wrapped up at the 25 by Charles Anthony. 55-yard punt, a 6-yard return. 9:15 left in the second quarter of play. Calgary holding on to a 3-point lead.
Back in Regina, Calgary leading 13-10. Top of the show, we talked exclusively about the wind and what it would do to both offenses and kicking games. You can see the Baltimore pendant right there. We've had gusts anywhere from 25 to 50 miles an hour. And you could see the average for Josh Miller. He's a 47-yard average. Against the wind, he was 33. With the wind right there, he was 50-plus. Just shows you the difference. Wally Buono knows it.
So in the fourth quarter, Calgary will have the wind advantage. They won the coin toss, and they chose to defer, so they'll get their chance.
They might not get the football in the third quarter, but what they want is the wind in the fourth quarter with a chance to win the football game.
Right now, with 9:15 left in the second quarter, they'll have it at their own 35-yard line, leading 13-10. Check that from the 26. Stewart running off tackle. And he's wrapped up by Matt Goodwin at the 27-yard line. Matt Goodwin last year was the CFL's most outstanding rookie and has turned in another quality performance this season with 50 tackles.
He's an excellent football player out of Iowa State. Defensive back who they made an outside linebacker. Remember, Don Matthews told us this team was set up to play Calgary. He's got two safeties playing outside linebacker, so they believe in speed, speed, and then a little more speed.
Pickup of only three, second down and seven from the 29. Flutie, option to the far side. Stewart, nowhere to go as he's wrapped up once again by the pursuing Stallions defense. Matt Goodwin getting there in a hurry.
in a lateral game, in a game of quickness, you are not going to out-quick Matt Goodwin. He's just too quick as an outside linebacker. Little option, trying to get the ball to Stewart outside. Matt Goodwin makes a great play.
Gain of only two, and that will bring on the punting unit.
You've noticed, Gus, so far in the second quarter, Calgary hasn't gone into their no-huddle offense once. They're trying to milk the clock against the wind.
Tony Martino standing at the 17-yard line. Chris Wright inches up closer now. He's at his own 47.
Field position battle.
And it's blocked. O.J. Brigance gets a piece of it. Ball heading towards the end zone. Picked up. And touchdown. Alvin Walton scores the touchdown for the Stallions.
It's been all special teams so far for the Stallions. A punt return for a touchdown, and now a blocked punt by O.J. Brigance with that man, Dirty Walton, scoring the touchdown. Watch what happens. It's a good snap. One step, two step, three steps, too long. Here comes Brigance with the block. And Alvin Walton, the former Redskin, number four, does a great job of locating the football, catching it on the hop, and getting into the end zone.
Alvin Walton leads his team in special teams tackles. He's a special teams player of the year for Baltimore. And in the right place at the right time last year in the Grey Cup, had an interception that he lateraled off for a touchdown. 7:39 remaining. Baltimore back on top, 17-13. Is O.J. Brigance. He blocked the punt that Alvin Walton recovered and got into the end zone for the touchdown. And O.J. Brigance, he's a warrior, playing in his 90th consecutive game. In 5 years, he's never missed a football game. And there are the turnovers, one apiece, resulting in scores for both teams.
But the difference in the football game is two special teams touchdowns for Baltimore, totaling 14 of their 17 points.
O.J. Brigance out of Rice was an All-Southwest Conference linebacker playing for the Owls. Also was an All-Western Conference player when he played for the B.C. Lions.
It's a stack right there to the right of your screen. Here he comes. They stacked in the middle. He came loose on the outside. And Alvin Walton does a great job picking it up and diving in the end zone. So Walton gets all the publicity, but Brigance made the play.
Alvin Walton, as we told you, intercepted a pass last year and lateraled it to one of the Anthony brothers for a touchdown against BC. From the 15, Coleman running up the sidelines, and he's wrapped up at the 30-yard line.
Coleman didn't like that late hit by Alvin Walton either. Alvin Walton, who just scored the touchdown, had 34 special teams hits this year and was the special player of the week for Baltimore seven times. The guy's just an animal. He was an all-league strong safety for the Redskins and just continuing to play extremely well.
Stampeders with the ball at the 31-yard line. First down, as you take a look at beautiful scenic shot of Taylor Field.
Is that our blimp?
Play action, Flutie has it batted down at the line of scrimmage. That's Elfrid Payton, and he looks right into the face of Doug Flutie.
Look, Payton can get it going a little bit too. They call his nickname Swack because he played in the Southwest Athletic Conference. Number 56. He knows he's not going to get to Doug, so he's just going to jump up, elevate, knocks it down, and then he's going to go find Doug and tell him about it.
Second down and 10 for the Stamps at the 31.
You got to block Payton. 18 sacks this year.
Here's Flutie again under pressure. Gets it off, incomplete. Intended for Allen Pitts. No flags on the play, and Flutie gets leveled as he releases the football.
Flutie got leveled, and Pitts got mauled coming off the line of scrimmage. Charles Anthony grabbed him. Watch this. Anthony, left hand, right hand. He misses him here. Now he's going to hold him. He's going to hold him again. Allen pushes off, and the ball's just a little bit overthrown. Good man-to-man coverage. Here comes Payton. He's a tough guy to block, and there's the hit on Flutie.
Calgary offense unable to get anything going. Here's Martino, fourth punt of the game. Standing at his own 17, Chris Wright at the 50-yard line. Low punt. Right slips. Ball bounces backwards. No yards. Flags have been thrown. And the whistle has finally been blown at midfield.
Martino's going to lose that battle with O.J. Begins every time. And I'll tell you what, they ran the same stack play. Matt Goodwin came clean, almost blocked that punt. Calgary having all kinds of problems blocking the pressure of the Baltimore front.
25-yard punt by Tony Martino.
As a player, I always got nervous when these guys started huddling up. You never knew what they were going to come out with.
And Dave Ewell will tell us.
We have illegal interference on the receiver. 15-yard penalty, 51 Calgary, first down.
That's Alondra Johnson. And Wally Buono can't believe it on the Calgary sideline. And that will give the Stallions legal position at the 40-yard line with 6:21 left to go in the second quarter of play. There's AJ.
Now they're in that same alignment they were in when they fumbled a little while ago. Look at the deep eye set with the late motion.
And they give it to Pringle straight ahead, and he'll pick up a couple. Gonzalo Floyd, as well as Matt Finley on the tackle for the Stamps.
You know, so far, Calgary's defense has been more than up to the challenge of Mike Pringle. 7 carries for 41 yards. Will Johnson head-to-head with Sharp Radonish. There's a matchup of a couple studs right there. Both of them all-league players. Little standoff.
Second down and 8. Ham. Plenty of time. Steps up. Delivers. Incomplete. Robert Clark had a chance to make a catch. Would have been a tough one, but one he should have made.
That's the third time tonight Robert Clark had a chance to make a play and came up empty. You get the athletic ability here. Marvin Pope working on Big Neil Fort. 330 pounds against 250.
And the Stallions offensive line doing a good job. This is the same line for the 6th consecutive week. Carlos Huerta in to attempt a 45-yard field goal, and it's good. But there are flags on the play.
That was a 3rd-and-7 situation. The back judge underneath the goalpost threw the flag, which is highly unusual.
There's no infraction on the play. Field goal is good.
So an inadvertent flag, and the field goal stands. So with 5:11 left in the second quarter, Baltimore leads 20-13. And Doug Flutie connect for a 27-yard gain. So the Stamps have it first down and 10 from the 48-yard line of Baltimore. Flutie out of the shotgun. Throwing to the sidelines, Tony Stewart out of the backfield, runs over the first defender and gets inside the 40, down close to the 35. Charles Anthony pushing him out of bounds. Doug Kraft getting run over on the play.
Good job by Flutie taking what the defense will give him, which in this case is halfback Tony Stewart underneath the zone coverage. And when he catches the football, he's just going to run. Douglas Kraft, his ex-teammate right there. First down again, but they're going to measure.
Tony Stewart, 56 receptions for 504 yards on the season to go along with 735 yards rushing.
But when you talk about the most prolific passing team in the CFL, you talk about Terry Vaughn had 72 catches, Sapunjis 111, Pitts 100. You lose Pee Wee Smith, who had 58 catches, but your running back still had 56. So.
And that doesn't account for, did you count for Vince Danielson?
Well, everybody, you're exactly right. He had over 50. Everybody talks about the slots on this team, but everybody produces and they spread the football around.
Flutie and Garcia, great job going to everybody one time or another. First down from the 38. Flutie gets rid of it quickly, and in his face again was Alfred Payton, and he continues to talk to Doug Flutie. And Doug is probably going to get tired of seeing him.
He's a fiery guy on the field. I spent about 10 minutes, 15 minutes with him at practice yesterday. He's a very low-key guy, but look at him right there. He's like shot out of a gun on that one. They were trying to pull the guard, but the guard had no chance. He was out there so quickly.
All Southwest Conference, Southwest Athletic Conference player for Eddie Robinson at Grambling. Second down and 10 from the 38. Flutie buying some time, flushed out of the pocket, and it's broken up. Broken up at the last moment by Chris Johnson, the starting free safety, first-year player out of San Diego State.
Did a nice job following Flutie and then breaking late on the football. That's what differentiates a good defensive back from an average one, an ability to break on the football. Chris Johnson did a great job there.
Johnson trying to come up with his fifth interception in seven games. He's the fifth man to play free safety for the Stallions this year.
Now, last year when they went to the Cup, Gus, all five of their starters played in every single game. This year, the defensive backs for Baltimore have been beat up. They've lost Lester Smith, Carl Anthony.
And here's Mark McLaughlin, a 44-yard field goal attempt into the wind.
Against the wind. Looks like it's died down a little bit, but before the game, he couldn't get close from here.
Doug Flutie is his holder. And it's no good. Shanked.
Oh, man.
I guess it really isn't any good, is it?
And that was like a three iron that just ugly from the minute you hit it.
So McLaughlin trying to drive. He shanks it off his foot, and Baltimore holds on to a 2013 lead. Squad has become so successful is because Jim Speros hired that man. Don Matthews, a Canadian coach with experience in the Canadian Football League, and when he built this team, he had a pretty good model.
Well, I think what we've got is a bad weather football team. I think that if the weather's bad, and if the wind really affects the passing game in a bad manner, then I think the advantage goes to the team that can run the football, and we've been running it all year. So we've got a tailback and an offensive line that used to doing that, and I think that that would be to our advantage.
Don Matthews talking about the weather conditions favoring.
Yeah, he's hoping all week for bad weather because he thinks it takes Doug Flutie out of the offense and just lets him run his normal tailback oriented offense.
First down and 10. Ham spots his receiver. This is Chris Armstrong, his first catch of the game, but he goes down at the 12.
When they throw the football, that's the guy they've got to start to find, Chris Armstrong. Robert Clark has dropped three already. Armstrong's one of the best wide receivers in this league. Big, strong guy, 6'2", 200 pounds, runs a 4.5. Both of them slip on the field. Armstrong's called down. But, Gus, they got to find a way in the pass game to get him the football.
Armstrong, 64 catches on the year for 1,111 yards. Second down and 7. Ham all day, and he goes down. Shreko Zizekovic managed to surge through the line of scrimmage, and he comes up with the sack.
You hear people talk about a coverage sack. That's exactly what that was. Tracy had plenty of time. He gets off the block of number 66, Neil Fort, and Shreko Zizekovic makes the play. Now, I had a chance before the game today down in the locker room to talk to Shreko about, he's a Canadian-born kid, but he went to Ohio State. We had a little talk about John Cooper and the Ohio State club this year.
Miller punting out of his own end zone, wobbly kick. Gets over the head of Marvin Coleman, takes a Baltimore bounce, and goes all the way down to the 37-yard line.
That is huge. The fact that the ball was not handled by Calgary now puts them on the long field into the wind. Big, big leg by Josh Miller.
69-yard punt by Miller.
Great punt by Miller, but inexcusable with a double safety back not to be able to handle that football.
Marvin Coleman misjudging the ball as it goes over his head.
Yeah, they had a double safety, and Marvin had to be best, saved him 20 yards.
So Flutie takes over at the 38. Trailing 20-13. They set up the screen on the near side, right through the wickets of David Zapudges.
Through the wickets?
Through the wickets.
You a cricket player?
Oh, well, you know, I watch it every now and then. I think I got that on SportsCenter somewhere.
I like that. That was good. Through the wickets. Remind me of Bill Buckner.
I'm sure Boston fans are familiar with that. So David Zapudges and Flutie unable to hook up there, makes it second down and 10 as you take a look at John Huffnagel, the offensive coordinator for Calgary. Flutie, short drop, plenty of time, checks off two receivers finally underneath, and Tony Stewart can't hang on to the football as Chris Johnson is there defensively for Baltimore.
Excellent coverage by Baltimore. Huffnagel actually sent six receivers, including his running back, Tony Stewart, into the pattern. But they were all covered. Flutie forced to eat the ball and then throw it late.
Baltimore defense doing an excellent job of containing this high-powered offense from Calgary. And they'll get the ball again, a minute 55 seconds left to go in the first half of play, leading 20-13. Martino at the 24-yard line. Good snap. And a wobbly kick, which is actually heading backwards.
Watch Martino. He's going to recover it himself.
And there's Chris Wright. Picks up the ball. Gets out of bounds at the Calgary 50.
Now, they ref threw a flag for no yards, but he shouldn't have thrown it because Tony Martino, the punter, is allowed within the five-yard bubble. They're going to talk about it and wave that flag off. Great hustle play. Bad kick by Martino, but great hustle play.
A 12-yard punt by Tony Martino.
No yards. Calgary 83. 5-yard penalty. First down.
So they call it against Tyrone Williams instead of calling it against Tony Martino.
Martino was within the 5 yards. I think that was a bad call. But anyway, great field position for Baltimore.
From the Calgary 46-yard line. Tracy Ham out of the shotgun. Three receivers to the far side. And it's almost intercepted. Marvin Coleman almost stepped in and picked that one off. He's got three interceptions in two plays. Had two against Hamilton.
And don't ever throw the ball late across the field with Marvin Coleman in coverage. Look at it. He actually even overran the football. He had such a good break on it. Tracy Ham should have never thrown the football there.
Second down and 10 from the 46. Coleman, also out of Central State. A Northern Division All-Star this season, at six interceptions on the year. Ham, under pressure. Fires, incomplete. Skinny Culver, the intended receiver, but a flag is thrown. Maybe pass interference against the Stampeders. Al Jordan covering for Calgary.
Penalty's going to be on Baltimore. The only question is whether or not Calgary will take the holding penalty or not.
Holding, Baltimore number 64. Penalty decline, third down.
Now the question there, remember, Baltimore's with the wind. Mark Dixon holds, number 64, middle of your screen. You can see right there the jersey of Gonzalo Floyd stretching. But the point is right now, you decline the penalty, which is the safe play. 53-yard attempt by Huerta, but he's got the wind with him.
So Carlos Huerta will attempt the 52-yarder. 53-yarder. And it looks like it's long enough, and it's good. Huerta nails the 53-yard field goal. And Baltimore, with a minute and 30 seconds remaining in the first half. They go up 23-13.
But that was my point. Do you take the holding penalty there to force him back out of field goal position, or do you force him to kick that? He was 3-for-6 during the year, over 50 yards, so you know he's got the leg for it.
Huerta, in only two seasons, has become the most accurate kicker in CFL history. He's 95 of 118.
And generally, Gus, he does not kick with a tee because he's trying to show the NFL he's ready to step right in and play next year.
Calgary down 23-13. Here's Tony Stewart running on the delayed handoff, finally dragged down by Anthony. Gain of 7.
Good call out of the shotgun, little draw with a minute and 25 left in the first half. Picks up about 8 yards. Down 10 points going into the wind here. They got to try and figure out a way to get some points on the board before half.
Clock still running. Second down and 2 from the 43 for the Stampeders. Stewart the lone setback. And here he is running off tackle again, and no room at all for him as Demetrius Maxey comes up with the hit.
Win from the outside, Maxey, the big defensive tackle from the inside, nowhere to go. You know, Maxey's one of those guys they picked up during the season. Big, strong inside guy. Doesn't get to the quarterback a whole lot, but he's great against the run.
Maxey, also out of UTEP, was a teammate with Gonzalo Floyd. Now don't forget, coming up at halftime, Larry Smith, the commissioner of the CFL, and Jim Speros will be talking with our Mike Mayock. Lisa hits the town with Jeff Garcia's home video camera, and we'll also have the 1995 CFL Player Awards.
Good stuff.
There's Flutie and Huffnagel talking. John Huffnagel was a quarterback at Penn State under Joe Paterno. Also played in the NFL and here in the CFL.
Played 12 years up here, played 3 years for Denver. Great football guy.
A minute 13 left in the half. Third down and 2, Flutie with a blocker in front of him. He is going to take this one himself and pick up the first down. And he gets to the 50-yard line. Matt Goodwin with the tackle.
That's Doug's favorite play, probably going back to Natick High School, certainly at Boston College. Little bootleg action, and Jamie Crisdale, his center, 67, will come out in front of him. See the fake to Tony Stewart. Crisdale, number 67 in front. It's a planned run all the way, first and 10.
First down from the 51. Flutie in trouble. And he runs and is hauled down from behind. That's Maxey again. Second time we've called his name. And Flutie will only pick up about 3 yards on the play.
When you rush a guy that like Flutie that can run the football, spacing between your four front men is critical, so there's no gaps. That's a great job by Maxey, falling back off and making the play.
43 seconds remaining in the half.
That was
second down and 9. Incomplete, but it's caught. This is Pitts, right place at the right time.
Allen Pitts' first catch of the half, and he's lucky the football eventually got to him. Hey, nothing wrong with a little bit of luck. Break on the football, it goes through two people, and Allen says, okay, I'll take it.
Allen Pitts looking the ball in. Great concentration there. First down from the 41. Flutie in trouble again, and he goes down at the 46-yard line. That's Demetrius Maxey coming up with the sack at the 46.
Big half for Demetrius Maxey. Just in this series, that's 3 consecutive plays that man has made. We have flags down. I think it's going to be offsides, Calgary, and decline.
Criminal procedure, Calgary 18, second down.
Wally Buono has to come up with something now. We've got under a minute. We're down to 22 seconds and counting. They're outside of field goal range.
5-yard loss. They set up the screen. Here's Stewart. He loses his footing and gets back to the original line of scrimmage.
Tracy Gravely made the force on that. All it does, as Gus just said, is back to the line of scrimmage, the 42-yard line. You've got to get closer for a more realistic field goal opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
So are you surprised with the way this Calgary offense has looked here in the first half?
Let's face it, neither offense has really been explosive. Baltimore gets 14 points off the special teams. Calgary has sputtered, especially against the wind. Second half will tell the story. I really believe this game will go into the fourth quarter with either team having a chance to win the football game.
Calgary averaging 434 yards per game in total offense, 355 yards passing, led by that man there, Doug Flutie. But right now, his team operating with a deficit, trailing 23-13.
12 seconds, you're trying to get one completion down the field, close enough for a field goal attempt.
Out of the gun.
There it is.
Near side, incomplete. Terry Vaughn misjudging the football.
You also saw the effects of the wind, throwing directly into the wind. The ball sailed on him a little bit. He's wide open in the flat. This would have put it into field goal range. Watch what happens. Just a little bit over Terry Vaughn's outstretched hands, and that's going to bring up a long third down situation. The question is field goal. Check that. First and 10, Baltimore.
Stampeders turn it over on downs. From the 42, 7 seconds left in the half. Looking for a big completion, underneath, incomplete. Intended for Chris Armstrong. Tracy Hamm has been underthrowing his receivers today.
Really a tough wind to gauge. Winds behind you sometimes, swirling sometimes.
So with only 3 seconds remaining, second down and 10 for Baltimore from the 42. This will be the last play of the half. Hamm will let it go. Drummond at the 50, and he goes down inside the 50. Marvin Coleman making the tackle for the Stampeders. So at the end of one half of play, the Baltimore Stallions will head into the locker room with a 23-13 lead in this, the 83rd Grey Cup from Taylor Field in Regina. Once again, Gus Johnson, Mike Mayock. Very interesting, as you talked about, the special teams really making the difference here in the first half.
Well, we heard Don Matthews say to win the football game, Chris Wright had to make a play. What happens? First punt return, bang, 82 yards, touchdown. But then after that, they block the punt. O.J. Bergantz does a great job. Alvin Walton picks it up for a touchdown. 14 points off special teams, advantage Baltimore.
In terms of adjustments for both offenses in the second half, what do you think needs to be made?
Well, let's be honest about it. Both offenses were sporadic at best. Calgary came out with a no-huddle fire offense in the first quarter, pure conservative in the second quarter. Be interesting to see what they do with the wind in the second half.
Well, Baltimore leading with one half remaining here in the Grey Cup. And coming up at halftime, we've got a full schedule, including a talk with the commissioner, Larry Smith, as well as Baltimore's Jim Speros. So stay with us. We'll have more from the 83rd Grey Cup right after this quick commercial timeout. Stay with us, everybody.
Regina, Saskatchewan, where the Baltimore Stallions at halftime leading the Calgary Stampeders by a score of 23-13. Hi, everybody. I'm Mike Mayock, and I'm joined here at halftime by the commissioner of the CFL, Larry Smith. And, Larry, pretty interesting first half of football.
Well, Mike, you know, with the weather conditions, it was really a half that depended on special teams. And both teams are really going at it, but Baltimore's got great special teams. Chris Wright opens it up, blocked the punt. There you go, 14 points in a game like this. That's big time.
Okay, Larry, let's talk a little bit about what's going to happen with the CFL. Big day coming up. To preface this for the American public, on November 29th, the Board of Governors meets. Larry, you're in the fourth year of a five-year contract. Do you expect them to come out with a vote of confidence for you?
Well, I would think so. I think we've done a lot of positive things, Mike, and obviously our expansion in the States right now is we're under some duress because Jim Spiros may have to move in Baltimore. We may have a couple of other guys who have to move also, but, you know, we never thought it would be easy, but I think it's going to work out, and the owners feel the same way.
Well, let's talk about the expansion. It's really a tough situation. The Canadian Football League needed money. You guys expand into the states. There's a fee that comes into it. You've been criticized by some people for expanding too quickly. Yet, do you feel like the league subsiding, continuing, depends on the expansion?
Well, I think that expansion has done two things. One, it's regenerated interest in Canada. And two, we have started to penetrate the United States. It's a big market, but it's a four-down football market. We're coming in with a slightly different product, which we excellent. The feedback we've received from the fans in U.S. cities is very positive. But it takes time, Mike. You have to be patient.
Now, listen, five teams south of the border, one run by Jim Speros in Baltimore, had a great year. The other four, somewhat questionable as far as fan support. How many communities will be in the same place as they were last year south of the border?
Well, I think, Mike, we may have two to three teams potentially moving this year. But, you know, the most important thing is we get Jim reestablished. We get some commitment out of our U.S. owners. We can make this work in the States because the fans watching the game see constant action. The other thing is it's affordable pricing. We got 104-year-old institution. Even though it's from Canada, we're giving something the American fans want because it's so darn expensive to go to other professional sports games.
Quickly, give me an economic snapshot of the league as it stands today.
Well, we're very stable from a league perspective. Our Canadian operations have improved dramatically. We have to get our U.S. operations more established, build up our fan base, build up local sponsorship. We'll be okay.
Well, thank you very much, Commissioner Larry Smith. Good luck next year with the expansion. And please stay tuned because coming up next, we're going to have a great week with Jeff Garcia, who took some videos of his own, both here in Regina, down in the field, and everywhere. Jeff, I was in the locker room after the game. You guys were all pumped up, and I think I even saw you walking around with a video camera, didn't I?
Oh, yeah, it was great. Here, take a look. Good job, Willis.
Right on, babe. We're going. We're going.
All right, all right.
You know what I'm saying? I like that.
I hear you. Jamie. Is that all you can say, Jamie?
Slick, you know, slick.
One of the cup, babe. We're going to win it.
Right on.
I'm bringing you.
Celebration time.
Hey, remember last week we're practicing, right?
All right.
And we'll practice on three again.
Practice on three again next week.
Hip, hip.
Mine's lighter.
Hey, Garcia, baby!
Woo! I see you, Vinny. Good game, baby.
Sweet, buddy. Sweetness.
What you got to say, Martino? Come on, you're better than that. Give me something. Get it off, Bobby.
Baltimore Stallions lead the Calgary Stampeders at the half 23-13. And on Thursday night, the league announced its 1995 Chrysler Player Award winners. Let's run them down for you. The most outstanding defensive player this year, Edmonton's Willie Pless. Five straight years as the Eskimos' top defensive player, Pless led the league this year with 100 tackles.
And the most important thing that my mom always told me was to do the best I could in everything I do.
And her last acknowledgement was, Willie, go out and play the game.
Outstanding rookie again from Edmonton, Shalon Baker. The Eskimos have a long tradition of great pass receivers, and Shalon Baker hopes to be the newest addition to that list. 79 receptions in 1995, 1,156 total yards, netting him an average of 14.6 yards per catch.
I have to give credit to my teammates, my family, and the Edmonton Eskimo organization who helped me get here.
Top offensive lineman this year, Baltimore's Mike Withycombe, a CFL rookie this year with six seasons in the NFL and World League. Withycombe was the anchor of an impressive Baltimore line that led the way for Mike Pringle. He was an obvious selection, 6'5", 300 pounds.
And I just got to thank all the guys that I played with, because I've had a really good time this year, and I've just had the most fun I've ever had playing professional football. So, thank you.
The Sponge soaks up his second Outstanding Canadian Award. That is Dave Sabungis. His numbers speak for themselves. 111 catches, 1,655 yards, and 12 touchdowns. Oozing consistency with 271 receptions in the last three seasons.
I said last week that I wanted to come here for the nominations, but more importantly, I wanted to come here with 36 other guys, and we did it last week, and they've been, a lot of them are here tonight supporting me, as well as my owner, my coaches, and other people in the organization, and this award here is a real tribute for all of them, not just myself.
And finally, the league's outstanding player, Mike Pringle, the Baltimore running back, no question, the offensive leader of the Stallions. Number one rusher this year for the second straight time, ran for 1,791 yards, 311 carries, scoring 13 TDs. He also led the league with total yards from scrimmage, 2,067.
I'm glad I won this award because it gives me another opportunity to publicly thank my teammates. You know, I can never get enough of thanking them. I have a little temper out there sometimes, and I don't think they really realize how much I love all my players, from the offensive line to the defensive side of the ball to Tracy Ham. Everybody out there giving 110%. I like to thank them publicly right now. I mean it from my heart. I love you all.
Congratulations to the five most outstanding players of 1995.
And festivities continue here at halftime of the 83rd consecutive Grey Cup. Baltimore Stallions leading 23-13 over the Calgary Stampeders. And joining me now is the owner of the Baltimore Stallions, Jim Speros. And Jim, you're one of the few owners I know with experience as a professional player and coach. Your view of the first half?
Well, I tell you what, it's become a defensive battle. Both defenses have neutralized the offenses, and it's broken down now to special teams. There is some weather factors here. I look for the same thing in the second half. We do know Doug Flutie wants to throw the football, so our defense is going to have to buckle down and keep doing what they've been doing in the first half.
Speaking of special teams, let's talk a little bit about that NFL club in Cleveland moving into your backyard. What's going to happen?
Well, I tell you what, we've got a championship caliber team, back-to-back great cups, great fan support. I meet with our governor, Paris Glendening, on Tuesday, and with our mayor, Mayor Schmoke, to keep our football team in Baltimore. We want to be there. We deserve to be there.
Flat out, is there enough fan support to support both an NFL team and a CFL team in the city of Baltimore?
Well, it's going to come down to how much local support we get from our state and government officials to say, listen, you're our team too. Give us that vocal support. Give us that financial support so we'll be there. We're at Memorial Stadium for three more years with a lease.
Well, I've been impressed as a football guy the way you, Jim Speros, hired another football guy, Don Matthews, and gave him autonomy and picked the players and coaches he needed to build a team. But in the background, you've been selling this club to the whole Baltimore community.
Hey, Mike, I'm on their shirt tails. I'm here because the players on the field and this coaching staff. These guys are professional athletes at their highest. You know, they've stuck together. They're more mature this year. And I want to make sure that they'll play in Baltimore and be appreciated, because these guys are champions. Don Matthews was my best hire from day one.
Well, let's talk a little bit about, if Baltimore doesn't work out, what are some of the options out there for your club?
Well, I tell you what, we've had a lot of inquiries from a number of cities. It's no secret I've been to Houston already. I've met with the Astrodome officials. I've talked to their mayor, Mayor Bob Lanier. But right now, my objective is that I'm from Maryland. This team belongs in Maryland, and I'm going to leave it up to the government officials to make sure they keep us there.
Now, Houston, of course, has been stung by the Oilers moving to Nashville. What's your view of American expansion? Are you guys, you've got a big meeting coming up on the 29th. What happens?
Well, I tell you what, we have four owners that are committed to, you know, being here in 1996.
Four American owners.
Four American owners in four marketplaces. I think we have some opportunities in markets such as Portland, Milwaukee, Orlando, Miami. So we need good owners. It's not just about money. You've got to have owners that are committed, that get involved in the community, and they become a part of that community. That's key. You can't be an out-of-town owner in this league because we depend so much on ticket revenues in the seats. And if we get that, we can build on a television contract for the states.
Television contract, that's a big part in any professional league. What happens next year?
Well, I tell you what, we need to be on regional cable such as we are tonight on ESPN. We need to lock that in with the U.S. teams. You know, there's CBC and TSN in Canada. We need to develop our television markets with better ADI rating cities for the future. This year, 96 will come to be stability. From there, we'll keep adding. By the end of this, by year 2000, I see us being 8 teams in Canada, 8 teams in the United States with a network deal.
8 teams in Canada, 8 in the States. Who knows what the name of the league will be, but I guarantee you Jim Speros will be a big part of it. Stay with us, please. We're come right back. We're going to have Lisa Bowes paint the town. 23-13 at halftime. Baltimore leading Calgary.
We'd like to welcome you back to Taylor Field in Regina, where we're at halftime of the 83rd Grey Cup, and we sent our Lisa Bowles out to check out the nightlife here in Regina.
Just like any championship game, there's a lot of stuff going on off the field, and Regina is no exception. This is their first ever Grey Cup, and these people are pumped. So come on, Doug, let's go check it out. I just hope we can fit everything in. Oh, thank you, sir. Are you having a good time here at Grey Cup?
I'm having a great time, Lisa. Are you having a good time?
Oh,
a
marvelous time. This is for Regina.
Oh, I think it's good for Regina. The city's having a lot of fun. There's lots of stuff going on.
Tell you, Lisa definitely knows how to find a party.
I think she found every single one of them, Gus.
Well, anyway, let's take a look at some of the highlights from the first half of play. And
we talked at the top of the show the importance of special teams, and could Chris Wright break a touchdown? Well, look at this. First punt of the game, 82 yards, coast to coast, 4-3-5, 40-yard dash speed, huge play, 7-0 lead, Baltimore. And with the two field goals after that, first and goal, Marvin Pope, the defensive lineman, in the offensive backfield, slips into the end zone. Great catch. That made the score 13-7, Calgary. But special teams continue to play a big role. O.J. Brigance with the block. Alvin Walton, the former Redskin, picks it up on the 3-yard line, dives into the end zone, and it's a 17-13 Baltimore lead. Then at the end of the half, the little man with the big leg, Carlos Huerta, 53-yard field goal, and that's our score at half, 23-13.
Now let's look at each team individually, Mike, and we'll start with Calgary. When they had the win the first quarter, it seems like Doug Flutie may not have gambled or thrown the ball down the field with the offense as much as he would have liked.
Well, he kept trying to get into a rhythm, but he couldn't because of the special teams play by Baltimore. And what happened was he went no huddle, that fire offense that they have, but he couldn't get any consistency. And all of a sudden, it's the end of the quarter, he loses the wind, and they're losing the game 7-6.
And when you look at Baltimore defensively, they've gotten a lot of pressure on Flutie, but like the Calgary offense, their offense is also sputtered.
Both offenses sporadic at best. Elfrid Payton getting a lot of heat up the field on Doug Flutie. The Calgary defense doing a great job on Mike Pringle. Like great championship games often happen, Gus, field position, special teams, and defense. That's what wins championships.
Because of the weather, the statistics won't be overwhelming, and you take a look at them. Passing yards, 95 to 142. Anything jumping out at you, Mike?
The interesting thing is that Calgary clearly has the advantage in total yards, yet they're losing the football game by 10 points. The bottom line, as we've stressed all night from beginning all the way up through this point of halftime, is special teams. Baltimore's winning the special teams battle.
So we're getting ready to start the second half of play of the 83rd Grey Cup here from Taylor Field. And Baltimore Stallions have been in this position before. Last year they led the Grey Cup against BC only to lose in the final seconds on a Louis Pasaglia field goal. Let's see if they've learned from their heartache of last season, and let's see if they can keep this man.
Remember,
calm down, Doug Flutie.
Cold weather. He's had problems with the elbow. He had the tailbone hurt in the first half. He's going to try and stay as loose as he possibly can. Here's Doug's numbers for the first half. Not overwhelming, but certainly pretty good for the type of weather conditions we have right now.
Baltimore will receive the football to start the second half of play, and they will have the wind at their backs. As you take a look at Mark McLaughlin getting ready to send it away.
And Gus, you made the point at the beginning of the game. Calgary won the coin toss, deferred. That gives them the football with the wind in the fourth quarter of this football game. So this is a critical quarter for Calgary. They've got to shut out, not shut down. They've got to shut out Baltimore in the third quarter.
And for Baltimore, knowing that they're going to be playing into the win in the fourth quarter, they need to try to score as many points as possible.
Got to get after it, starting with that guy right there, Chris Wright, on special teams, going through Tracy Hamm and Mike Pringle. And one more thing they have to do is get the football to Chris Armstrong. Only had one reception in the first half.
The 83rd Grey Cup from Regina, it's ever been played here in the province of Saskatchewan. Next year, it will be in Hamilton. And the year after that, it was scheduled to be in Baltimore.
But the key to that, as Jimmy Speros told me in the airport the other day, is that he personally owns the rights to the 97 Grey Cup, not Baltimore. So if he moves to Houston or Northern Virginia, whatever, he has the rights.
And down on the sidelines, let's check in with Lisa Bowles.
Thanks very much, Gus. Tyrone Edwards, injured running back for the Calgary Stampeders, is with me. Tyrone, your assessment of the first half.
Well, I just think it's just been up and down. You know, our special teams needs to pick it up. And right now, you know, they only hurt us with two big plays, and that's it. Our defense is doing a good job. Our O just has to get on the field, make some long drives like we did last week, and just keep the intensity up.
Thanks very much for your time. Enjoy the rest of the game.
Thank you.
Tyrone Edwards, guys, back to you.
Now, Edwards played at Cal Berkeley, and he was behind Russell White. Remember, a couple years ago, White was a Heisman Trophy candidate at Cal Berkeley, and they consider him the back of the future. And with the way Tony Stewart has been fumbling the football this season, next year it probably will be a dogfight in training camp.
Now, you're pretty tough on Tony Stewart. He's a good football player, but like you've said and I've said before, the Achilles heel, the only downside to Tony Stewart is he will put the football back on the ground if you hit him hard enough.
As evident in the first half of play. So because of the extended halftime, it's taken a little extra time to clear off the field here in Regina. So they're trying to get fans off the field, off the edge of the field, so we can get the second half underway. Any key players besides the principals that we've talked about that we may want to keep our eyes on to start this second half?
Well, I think Chris Armstrong has got to get involved in the pass offense for Tracy Ham in the third quarter. He's with the wind. I think he's got to go get him in the third quarter and try and get his slot back Armstrong involved. And on the other side of it, for Calgary, well, let's face it, Doug Flutie's got to get on the corner and get some things going with Tony Stewart and his wide receivers.
As you take a look at Tracy Ham now, he has won the Grey Cup before, and he has played in the CFL for a number of years, coming out of Georgia Southern, where he won two national championships for Irk Russell. Rushed for 1,000 yards in college, has great legs, although he is getting a little bit older.
You know what's interesting is people talk about quarterbacks maturing, and generally people accept if you say that a quarterback was a scrambler, but he gets older and then he scrambles to throw as opposed to scramble to run. Well, the Calgary coaches are concerned about the they'd rather see Tracy Ham scramble to throw. They feel like he's more dangerous using his legs instead of his arms.
And in the CFL, both quarterbacks, usually the quarterbacks for each team, they call their own plays, and that makes the game even that much more interesting, because the guys out on the field are just kind of reacting to what they see as they approach the line of scrimmage.
It really is interesting because there's a combination. For instance, Doug Flutie generally will get signals wig-wagged into him through offensive coordinator John Huffnagel, but whenever they get in that fire offense, Huffnagel even tells us, he just kind of throws his hands up and says, well, it's out of my control. It's Doug's game now.
1984, Flutie led the Boston College Eagles over Miami in what they affectionately call in Boston the miracle in Miami, when what's that guy's name he hit in the back of the end zone? Gerard Phelan. So we're still having some problems getting the second half started, and we'll be back with the kickoff right after Chris Wright returns the football to the 44-yard line, and that's where the Stallions will begin the second half. First down and 10 from the 44. Mike Pringle, the lone setback for Baltimore, as Tracy Ham audibles at the line of scrimmage. This is Pringle trying to get outside, breaks one tackle, stays on his feet, turns a corner, and he's finally pushed out of bounds at the 48-yard line. Anthony McClanahan had a chance to haul him down, but he just couldn't do it.
That's that little bounce play. Pringle loves the play. Guard pulls out in front of him, but McClanahan, as you said, forced him to bounce it wider than necessary, and the pursuit caught up to him. This is where the Calgary defense eats people alive. Second and long.
Gain of only two. Second down, 8. Ham thought about going downfield. Can't find anybody. Runs. Scrambles out of bounds, but he'll be shy of the first down.
And Tracy's not happy with a couple of his receivers. He's looking for some help there, and he didn't get it.
Look at him. Tracy Ham in the first half, 7 of 17 for 95 yards.
He's still talking to Gerald Alfin.
And there's a name that we haven't called. Gerald Alfin was the all-star receiver in Winnipeg. Got released during the regular season, and a good pickup by Baltimore.
Got released because of money. It was a salary dispute. They asked him to take a pay cut. He said, no, thank you, and they sent him home to Atlanta.
Josh Miller, end-over-end kick. Takes a bounce, heads into the end zone, and this will be a single point. Marvin Coleman having all kinds of problems return today. So that's a single point for Baltimore, and with 13:54 left in the third quarter, they take a 24-13 lead. Little over a minute into the third quarter play as Baltimore gets an 80-yard punt by Josh Miller, and they pick up a single point, making it 24-13. Now, 80-yard punt, but Marvin Coleman allowed the ball to bounce into the end zone, and it bounced in front of him.
That's two consecutive punts with the wind where Miller had 69 and 80-yard punts, both misjudged by Marvin Coleman.
Stampeders will take over at the 35 after giving up the single. And in the first half of play, the two all-star slot backs, at least one of them, not having the kind of half he wanted. David Zapunges is 5 catches for 76 yards, but Alan Pitts only 1 catch for 16 yards. And the first time he played against Baltimore, he had 8 receptions for 104 yards.
I'm not convinced Alan Pitts is 100% healthy. He's had some problems late in the season, but still, they've got to get the football to Alan Pitts.
From the 35, 4 receivers on the far side, quarterback draw, Flutie, straight ahead, and he'll pick up about 7 yards, all down by O.J. Brigance. Now, we talk about the ability of Tracy Ham to run the football. This little guy can also get it downfield as well.
It goes without saying, either of these quarterbacks on the corner or on a quarterback draw, equally deadly. I mean, Doug Flutie made his reputation as the scrambling quarterback.
When Flutie played against the Stallions earlier this year, he was 32 of 49 for 405 yards. There's numbers there, 12 of 26. Picks up 8, second down and 2 from the 43. Stewart. Over the 50-yard line, he'll be up to the 53.
They're in the equivalent of what they call their double tight set, where they bring Jay McNeil, the extra lineman, in, and fullback Sean Daniels sneaks up there, right there, as you can see, and starts the block on the corner. And Tony Stewart's just going to get in right behind the big offensive line. Pandelitis with a good block, first down.
Gain of 10 yards, Tracy Gravely with the tackle. First down and 10 from the 53-yard line. Pitts in the slot. They run the counter tray. Stewart with the blocker in front of him. Gets spun around and finally knocked out of bounds by Matt Goodwin. Initial contact made by Charles Anthony on the force.
Let's see what... While we have a chance, let's go down to Lisa Bowes. Alfred Payton, we can off one block, getting hit by Rocco Romano on another. Stewart only picking up 2 yards.
Second down and 8 from midfield. Terry Vaughn splits to the far side along with Vince Danielson and David Zapunges in the slot. Flutie out of the shotgun. Underneath, complete. This is Pitts. Alan Pitts down to the Baltimore 45-yard line.
See, that's where Alan Pitts is most effective. It was a blitz situation, one-on-one coverage, and Flutie knows that he can use the size advantage. Look at the push-off, comes back to the football. That's 6'4", 210 on Charles Anthony, who's 6'1", 190. Advantage Pitts.
Pitts out of Cal State Fullerton had 100 receptions for 1,492 yards.
And he didn't even play the last 2 games of the year. This guy has been the most productive player in the league 2 years in a row.
From the 45, first down, inside handoff Stewart. He gets down to the 39-yard line. O.J. Brigance with the stop for the Stallions.
And let's not forget what's happening right now. They're controlling the clock against the wind. Payton comes up the field. The ball's going to go back inside him. Shoestring tackle on Stewart, but it's an effective drive against the wind, getting close to the red zone, Gus. This is exactly what they said at halftime they needed to do.
Pick up a 5, second down and 5 from the 40. Flutie rolling, gets rid of it, and he has a receiver. This is David Zapunges at the 32-yard line. Tracy Gravely there to bring him down, but Sponge picks up his 6th reception of the game.
Flutie ends up a little deeper than he expected on this play. Maxie's pushing him, Brigance is pushing him, but he does a nice job throwing the ball inside Payton for the first down to Zapunges.
And when you talk about Zapunges and Pitts in the history of the league, no two receivers have ever gone over 100 receptions. Zapunges this year with 111, Alan Pitts with 100. Here's Flutie on first down, again, complete, Terry Vaughn at the 20. 10-yard line. Doug Kraft with the saving tackle.
Baltimore is a man-to-man defensive coverage team, and that's one of the most effective plays against man-to-man. It's a crossing route. Vaughn will come from the right side, cross underneath the left, and he gets the defensive back, gets caught in the traffic. That's Goodwin trying to cover the wide receiver man for man. And that's mismatch advantage Vaughn every time.
Second catch of the game, game of 22 for Terry Vaughn now. Only the third time in the history of the league that three receivers have gone over 1,000 yards, the third being Terry Vaughn. Here's Doug Flutie. He wants to run it, and he is corralled at the 11 by O.J. Brigance. And he goes into a sack dance.
And the fans north of the border aren't real happy about it. Peyton runs himself out of the play up the field. Flutie takes it down. I thought he was going to take off. Just that hesitation gives Brigance the opportunity to make the tackle. Hog ties him and then does the dance. There it is. See, they had a curfew this week, Gus, so he had enough energy left over to do the dance that he couldn't do during the week.
Second down and 10 from the 11 for the Stamps.
Big play.
Their opening drive of the second half. Flutie in trouble again. Trying to get out of the way. Flutie turns the corner. And it'll be shy of the goal line. Ball will be spotted at about the one. And that may be enough for the first down. And there's that 4-5 speed of Doug Flutie.
The thing I like there, and you can see Doug is telling him how far. The thing I like is no hesitation. When he goes up the field, he knows he's running the football. This is when he's his best. Gets a great block by Tyrone Williams up the field. He gets to the corner, drops the helmet. Boy, that's a good play.
Charles Anthony making the saving tackle for the Stallions.
Good block by Tyrone Williams down the field on the linebacker, allowing Doug to get to the corner. Big, big call here. Third, not goal to goal here, as you said, Gus. They can still get a first down.
Third down and inches. Now, remember, in the CFL, the defense has to line up 1 yard off the football.
They're in their big set.
Tony Stewart, and Flutie gets over the goal line, and won't be a touchdown.
No call yet.
But he will pick up the first down for sure. Looks like he was in from our vantage point.
Remember, it's not the helmet. It's with the location of the football. Football has got to break the plane.
Request for a measurement.
It's in his left hand. You can see him turning and churning, but that ball's still in his left hand. From up here, I thought he was in the first time, but Gus, from there, no way. I think that's a good call. Problem now is the measurement.
And they do get the first down.
Now, the interesting thing, you saw where the ball was lined up on about the 3-inch line. Remember, in Canadian football, because of the 1-yard neutral zone, the ball gets brought back to the 1-yard line. He's churning and churning, but got down to about the 3-inch line. It's brought back to the 1-yard line, first and goal.
From the Baltimore 1.
They got the big set in, Pope and Zizikovic.
Flutie again over the right side. Touchdown Stamps. Doug Flutie, only his second rushing touchdown of the season. Makes it a 24-19 ball game.
Reverse angle going off the right side behind Crisdale, Pandelitis, and Romano. Not to be denied.
I remember one time you got on one of those horses in Baltimore.
You would have to bring that up.
Oh my
Welcome
God.
To the end of my broadcasting career.
Extra point is good. 7 minutes and 2 seconds remaining in the third quarter play. Baltimore now leads by only 4. Flutie is 6th rushing touchdown of the season, and Baltimore now leads by only 4 points. Let's go downstairs where our Lisa Bowles is standing by.
Thanks very much, Gus. Well, according to Stampeders linebacker Anthony McClanahan, the reason why Calgary's defense is having some trouble containing Pringle, this is his reason. Apparently, Pringle's got Vaseline all over him, especially his arms. Guys?
I'm not even going to make a comment about that, but obviously in the cold weather, a lot of guys generally will put substances on their body. But, I mean, he's got 9 carries for 48 yards. That's not too bad. That's containment as far as Calgary's defense is concerned.
And here's your scoring drive, 11 plays, 75 yards, capped off by the 1-yard touchdown by Flutie. But just as important is the time of possession.
That was a critical, critical drive, and they did exactly what the coach wanted at halftime.
6 minutes, 33 seconds. Chris Wright from the 25. Flags on the play. Wright with the seam up the middle. He'll get closer to the 50, but this will probably be brought back.
Yeah, I think they're going to get a block in the back on Greg Frères. Bring it all the way back. In the first half, everything went Baltimore's way, especially on special teams. There you saw a crease, but it's going to be brought back because of the block in the back.
And an illegal block in attendance today. 52,564. What a beautiful crowd here at Taylor Field in Regina for the 83rd Grey Cup.
Baltimore 14, 10-yard penalty, first down.
And for Baltimore, number 14 is Jason Bryant, first-year player out of Morehouse.
And he pushed Greg Frères right in the back, easy call.
And that pushes the Stallions back to their own 18-yard line. That's Alfin in motion. Play action. Ham to the near side. Robert Clark with the catch at the 30. And he'll get close to the 35-yard line. Robert Clark, after dropping 3 balls in the first half, comes out here in the second and catches his first.
Did an excellent job running the defensive back, Al Jordan, off deep enough and then coming back to the football. Watch what happens now. Little hitch. Now come back to the football. There it is. Jordan laying way off in zone coverage and then compounding it by missing the tackle.
Gain of 16. First down from the 34.
Blitz.
Underneath Alfin with the reception, and he'll get up to the 53-yard line. Gerald Alfin picks up 19 yards.
You know, the key to that play was tailback Mike Pringle picking up the blitz. McClanahan right up the middle to his right. Look to the right of that. Pringle picking up the linebacker, number 51, Alondra Johnson. That gave Tracy Ham enough time to find Alfin.
First down and 10 from the 52 for the Stallions. Fake, Ham, and he has it batted down at the line of scrimmage. Gonzalo Floyd, who replaced Kenny Walker during the regular season when Walker was traded away, comes up with the big play.
You can see Robert Drummond coming up from that. He was the intended receiver. Watch 84 and White. They've been coached this week. Don't try and get to the quarterback. Just keep the pocket and then jump in the air. Right there, Gonzalo Floyd. Now look at number 2 behind. That was the intended receiver, Drummond, and he hurt his knee.
Second down at 10. To the near side, Tui Bolotu. Looking for the first down marker, and he will be short. Anthony McClanahan with the tackle.
But that is where Calgary's defense is so disciplined. Second and long, they get in the zone, they bring their rush men up underneath, and then they force you to throw the football underneath, and then they tackle you short of the first down.
That'll make it third down and about a yard and a half.
We're going.
And they are going for it. Ham straight ahead. As he goes over the left side of Mike Withicombe and Shar Pordonish. Withicombe, the most outstanding lineman in the CFL this year.
Pordonish last year.
And which, what makes it more interesting, Withicombe wasn't even a starter at the beginning of the season. And Calgary, seem to think that they didn't make it.
That was a long yard right there. I think they're going to measure that. It was third and a yard and a half, in my opinion. Quarterback sneak is tough when you got more than a yard to go for.
Let's
Look at that. It doesn't get any closer than that. What's the call?
First down.
Look at Speziani. There's the eye of the tiger.
Another great season for Frank Speziani, another Penn State product. And while most of the attention goes to this offense of Calgary, his defense has won a lot of football games for this team this year,
especially in the playoffs.
Ham, plenty of time again, underneath, complete. Alvin hauled down at the 25-yard line. Tracy Ham doing a good job remaining patient, waiting for his receiver to break open.
And the key was protection. The protection allowed him to be patient. He cleared behind Alondra Johnson, beating Al Jordan across the field. Excellent play by Baltimore from beginning to end.
23-yard pickup, and keep your eye on Alfin. He is a veteran receiver as Tracy Ham goes down with a whole lot of experience in this league. And an all-star on first down after the 23-yard gain. Underneath again, and a great catch. That's Peter Tuipulotu, the backup fullback, sneaking out of the backfield, making the diving stab.
But don't ever forget Tuipulotu in your pass offense. A BYU running back, they all catch the football. Watch him extend, two hands. Great job, duck and huddle. Great job right there.
That looks like Cal Ripken going deep in the hole at Camden Yard.
Little backhand.
First down and 10 from the Stampeder 14. Here's Pringle. And he's stacked up at about the 13-yard line.
Gosh, you know what's interesting? The first half was all defense. Here in the second half, we've seen our first two excellent drives, one by each club. Calgary takes 6 minutes off the clock the first time, and here comes Baltimore right back at you.
Anthony McClanahan making the tackle. McClanahan out of Washington State. Led Washington State in tackles with 117. Was a second-team All-American player.
Hey, he's very quietly had an excellent season. 7 sacks for Calgary.
Second down and long. Ham throwing again. All day to throw the football. Steps up with running room. Ham towards the end zone. Touchdown, Baltimore. Decision making by Tracy Ham and some fabulous blocking by the offensive line.
What have we said three different times? That Frank Speziani and that Calgary defense were scared to death about what? Tracy Ham's legs. What a great job making decision. He's got nobody open early. The pocket stays formed. Pocket stays formed. And now he says, okay, my turn. Turns it on. He still can run for an old man. Touchdown.
On the season, Ham carried the ball 83 times for over 600 yards and had 4 rushing touchdowns. Extra point is good by Carlos Huerta. So the Stallions, they answer the bell and respond, and they take a 31-20 lead, 2:13 left in the third quarter. It's giving Tracy Ham great protection. That sharp Hordanish on the left was the most outstanding offensive lineman last year, and that offensive line doing a good job as Tracy Ham got into the end zone for a 13-yard score.
How about the guy next to him, though? 66, 330-pound Neil Fort. We talked about BYU. He was an offensive tackle at BYU.
And there's Tracy Ham. Scoring drive, 9 plays, 92 yards, 5 minutes, 3 seconds, and both teams eating up a lot of clock. Capped off by the 13-yard run.
That's 2 drives totaling over 11 minutes, about 11 minutes and 36 seconds. That's good offensive football displayed by both clubs.
So this game turning out to be one of those contests where you get the feeling that whoever has the ball last may win. And Huerta sends it away. This is Terry Vaughn inside his own 10. To the 40-yard line, pushed out of bounds at the 41 by Jason Bryan. 30-yard return for Terry Vaughn.
Reverse angle of the last touchdown. Tracy Ham doing a good job. Feeling the pressure from McClanahan and Johnson. Steps up, and at that point, he becomes a running back. Nobody's going to touch him. Good decision, better execution. But Gus, did you see how the pocket stayed formed around them? They just kept blocking, 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 and Tracy made something happen.
First down for the Stampeders at their own 41, trailing 31-20. Flutie slips, gets it off anyway, and it's almost intercepted. Charles Anthony had the ball hit him right in the face mask on the deflection. If he would have been able to hold on to that, he would have sprinted right into the end zone.
Coming late to Sapungis on this. Gravely will take a shot at him. He'll work back away from Gravely, and the ball will deflect off Sapungis' hands into Anthony's hands. Would have been six if he could have held on to it. Doug slips a little bit there again on that turf. Now watch the ball deflection. Oh, tip drill, Charles. You got to catch the football. That's six.
Second down and 10. Flutie underneath to Vaughn, and he's stacked up shy of the first down marker. That's Irv Smith, and he comes up with the tackle, so Calgary will be forced to punt. And Irv Smith was out of the lineup this season with an injury, but having him there is a very, very calming force, rather, for this secondary.
Well, he's a cover guy. He's a pure cover guy, and they're worth their weight in gold. He's an all-Southern Division player at the University of Maryland. Really a good football player.
Local kid.
That's right. Local boy makes good.
Stampeders forced to kick again. This is Martino. Last punt, only 12 yards, kicking right into this wind.
Set up the return.
End over end kick, fielded inside the 30 by Wright. Turns it upfield and watch him go. Chris Wright up to the 36-yard line, making something out of nothing.
He is so quick, it's scary. He's like one of those water bugs. He's so quick, if you're on the coverage team, you know if you blink, he's by you.
Ray Biggs with the special teams hit. So the Baltimore Stallions get the ball back at their own 35-yard line, leading 31-20 with 46 seconds left here in the third quarter of play. Ham out of the gun. They set up the screen. This is Clark. Breaks one tackle, gets up to the 40 and the 41. Stu Laird with the hit, but missing the tackle. Kenton Leonard for the Stampeders.
Leonard was shot out of a cannon, but misses the tackle. Clark on the screen. Watch him from the right side. Bang. Head down. Misses the tackle. Good job by Clark getting some yardage.
And I notice that Baltimore runs that screen a lot. How many yards are they trying to get when they run that play?
Well, it's a first down play. You're trying to get it so you get 6 to 8 yards and you get into an advantageous second down.
They get six, second down, four, underneath, complete again. Tracy Hamm just picking the Calgary Stampeders secondary apart right now. That's Chris Armstrong with the reception.
And I thought Greg Knox had a chance to make a play on the football.
And that's the end of the third quarter of play. One more left from Regina. Quarter stands in the way of the Baltimore Stallions taking their first ever Grey Cup and bringing it back to the United States. They lead the Calgary Stampeders by a score of 31-20 as we begin the fourth quarter. Gus Johnson, Mike Mayock with you for the 83rd Grey Cup here in Regina. Stallions with the football at their at the Calgary 52-yard line. First down and 10. Hand off to Pringle. Gets off the 50 up to the down to the 48. And take a look at the scoring by quarters. And in the second quarter of play, Baltimore 16-7. So far in the third quarter, they outscore 8-7.
Yeah, the big difference, obviously, is the second quarter. Good block there on Marvin Pope. Tackle by Alondra Johnson.
But on the season, Calgary has outscored teams 197-88 in the fourth quarter of play. Play action, Ham underneath the Culver. And did he catch it? Are they going to give it to him?
Boy, that
looks like they will. Skinny Culver. Looks like he juggled the ball from where I sit.
Bad job by the refs and waiting to make a decision here. Let's see what happens. Look, the ball is clearly caught above the ground, but I don't know if he had possession or not. Let's see from this angle. Better look at it. I think hard
hard to tell. The ball squirted at the end. I'm not sure.
Game 14. First down from the 34. Hand off Pringle. Running over the right side. Keeps his feet going, and he'll get close to the 30.
He got in behind big Mike Withycombe on that one. They pull the left guard. Now, Withycombe had a couple of good comments in the paper today. There's the inside handoff. Withycombe out in front. Look at the block he had on Will Johnson. Just pancaked him right on his back. That's why he was the lineman of the year. You know, Gus, Baltimore had a curfew all week. Calgary didn't. And they asked Withycombe about it. He said, hey, let them party. He said, this is a business trip for us.
And according to some reports, some of the Stampeder players were partying.
Were they individual reports, or did you hear that from a third-party source?
Actually, I heard it from a coach. Here's Ham underneath, and Pringle holds on to the football, gets up, and gets the first down.
That's a huge non-call by the refs. When he was down, it was not a first down. When he got up, he picked up three more and a first down. Great hustle play by Michael Pringle.
So Mike Pringle picks up the first down, and the drive continues for the Stallions.
Matt Finley possibly playing his last game
from the 23. Pringle again, straight ahead, and he gets body slammed to the turf, but gets inside the Stampeders 20-yard line. That's Anthony McClanahan with the tackle.
Tell you one thing. I think Baltimore is setting up the outside linebackers for the naked bootleg. Finley, straight handoff inside, pure power football. Big hit, McClanahan and Pringle, helmet on helmet. I think Baltimore is setting up the naked boot with Tracy Ham sometime soon on the corner.
McClanahan had 38 tackles during the regular season. This is a quarterback draw. Ham straight ahead, and he needed to get to about the 14-yard line for the first down, and he's at the 15 right now. Maybe the 13-yard line.
Comes the field goal team. Calgary's rush defense has been the best in the league, 55 yards a game tonight against the best running attack in the league. They've given up 81 early in the fourth quarter.
Carlos Huerta in to attempt a 22-yard field goal. Dan Crowley is holder, and it's blocked. Blocked at the line of scrimmage. And the Stampeders recover at their own 7. Looks like Shreko Zizekovic may have gotten a paw on it. 11-12 left in the fourth quarter of the Grey Cup. Calgary trailing Baltimore 31-20. And welcome back to Taylor Field, 31-20. 11-12 left in the fourth and final quarter of play of the 1995 Grey Cup. And the blocked field goal by Shreko Zizekovic gives the Stampeders the ball at their own 9.
Special teams continue to be the story of the game. 22-yard attempt. The ball doesn't get up very quickly, and Zizekovic with his right hand makes the block, and it's recovered by Gerald Vaughn. That saves a sure 3 points because Huerta is not going to miss from 22. I mean, he was 13 for 13 during the year between 20 and 29 yards.
Taking an aerial look at Taylor Field here in Regina, and it is filled to the rim
from the Gus Johnson blimp.
A beautiful night here in Western Canada, Prairie Town, Regina. There you take a look at Shreko. He wants to be an actor.
From the right of your screen, the big hand goes up. He catches him right in the elbow. No question that ball was kicked too low, Gus. Way too low.
Shreko Zizekovic, 6'5", 260. And he used all of his height on that play. So Doug Flutie starts from his own 8-yard line. First down. Out of the gun to the near side. And this one down. Grant Carter bats the football down. And he has just been having an outstanding playoffs.
He's really a good football player. Quiet guy. After they picked him up, their defense solidified. Carter, number 54, gets the big paw up right there. Almost catches the football. Great job by Carter.
Carter, second year out of Pacific. Makes a second down and 10 from the 8. Here's Flutie again, passing. Steps up, wants to run, and he will not pick up the first down. Stifling defense of Baltimore will force Calgary to punt it again.
Critical second down situation right there. Good coverage in the secondary. That will force a punt from inside their 10-yard line. Here comes Carter again. He's really quick. Good block from the inside out by Pandelitis on Carter. Little double team action.
Stallions standing to get great field position again. So far, Doug Flutie, 16 to 32 for 188 yards.
Watch this guy.
And Chris Wright is standing at the 47. Martino gets off a good one. This is Wright on the far sidelines. Not a lot of room, but he will get inside Calgary territory at about the 54.
And the reason that was such a great punt was not just the distance, but the location. Kicked in between the numbers and the sideline. You can funnel more defensive cover guys right into that area. That's how you stop a good return man.
Fans here in Regina doing the wave.
Now, this is Mike Pringle's quarter right now. Fourth quarter, 11-point win lead, and you're against the wind. Offensive line and Pringle.
First down from the 53. Pringle turning it outside. Plenty of room. Mike Pringle gets down inside the 45 at about the 44. Upended by Gerald Vaughn. But Pringle picks up close to 8.
Did you see that? Gerald Vaughn started talking some stuff to him, and Pringle just turned around and pointed at the scoreboard. Gets outside contain, watch the hit, the flip right there, and then the jawing started.
Mike Pringle picks up 8 yards, second down, and 2 from the 45. Here he is again, and another first down for the Stallions.
I'll tell you what this is. This is Don Matthews and Steve Barato, the offensive coordinator, throwing down the gauntlet right now to Calgary's defense. And what they're going to say is, we've got the best offensive line in the league. We got the best tailback in the league. Try and stop us.
On the season, Stallions have been averaging 153 yards rushing per game. Pick up another first down there.
You see Tracy a little bit on bootleg, but aside from that, here they come.
From the 42. Another counter Trey. Pringle getting outside, turns it up, and gets down to the 34-yard line.
Gonzalo Floyd had a shot at him in the backfield and missed it. Actually, it was Will Johnson had the shot, number 81. Plays off Drummond. Now use your quickness and get outside. Just misses the tackle. Pringle strong enough to run through. Look at the strength in his lower body. Picks up 8 yards. Great run.
So far, 81 yards rushing for Mike Pringle.
Calgary's got 8 guys in the box.
Here's Ham. Looks like a broken play. And Tracy Ham. He'll get back to the line of scrimmage. Anthony McClanahan with the tackle.
Looked like Tracy wanted to check out of something. He had the same pre-read I did, which was that they were bringing the house. Too many people against the play called.
That'll force a field goal try once again by the Stallions on third down and 2. This is a 41-yarder by Carlos Huerta, the former All-American out of the University of Miami. Last one was blocked. But not this one. Carlos Huerta nails the 41-yarder. And Baltimore takes a 34-20 lead with 7:31 left in the football game.
Huerta makes the score 34-20. There's offensive coordinator Steve Barato. Great coach, but also, Gus, before the game today was very sick. He's usually down on the field. They bumped him upstairs because they didn't even know if he was going to make it through the game.
Another field goal by Carlos Huerta makes it a 34-20 Baltimore lead. So far, Huerta 4-for-6 on the day. And in the playoffs, he's 13 of 20. He's accounted for 20 points already.
I mean, let's add it up. You've got Huerta's points. You've got one scramble by Tracy Ham for a touchdown, and all the rest is special teams. Baltimore's winning this football game on special teams and some good defense.
Doug Flutie underneath. This is Tony Stewart. Stewart with a burst of speed, and he gets up to the 50.
You're going to see Doug Flutie in the fire offense right now. No huddle. The game is in his hands.
There's O.J. Brigance, gain of 15.
Baltimore probably playing a little more zone now.
Flutie, side-arming it out, incomplete. Intended for Vince Danielson, gravely defensively for Baltimore.
Pure zone drop by Baltimore with a 14-point lead and just about 7 minutes left. Doug chose the short pass here. Gravely does a great job breaking on the football. If you're going to throw that one, it's got to be on the sideline portion. It can't be inside.
Second down and 10. Stampeders need to make something happen here. Flutie going up top for Pills, and it's intercepted. Charles Anthony with the interception at the 26-yard line.
Bad read by Doug Flutie. Went backside. He had two guys going deep. Tried to force one in, and Charles Anthony had it all the way.
Anthony had 5 interceptions during the regular season. None bigger than that one there. Big interception by Charles Anthony, and the Stallions get the ball back once again on the Doug Flutie interception, and nothing has gone right for this Stampeders offense so far, but I tell you what, you gotta tip your hat to this Baltimore Stallions defense.
Excellent defense, led by Darryl Adralin and Bob Price, defensive coordinator.
Six minutes and 35 seconds left in the football game, 34-20. Calgary, with such a good running attack, they're going to try to take as much time off the clock as possible in hopes of being able to take that precious trophy south of the border.
Some cop in New Jersey having to wear an outfit like that?
In Hoboken. First down from the 27. Pringle, search series, and he has plenty of room up to the 32-yard line.
Both guards, Withycombe and Dixon, out in front, just like we talked in the last series, and that is big offensive line, Mike Pringle, you guys got to stop us.
We're gonna bring it on home. And there's Charles Anthony and Alfred Payton. Gain of 6 yards, 2nd down and 4. Calgary's quarterbacks threw 12 interceptions during the regular season, 6 in the playoffs. Pringle again, first down as he sheds blockers and gets up to the 40-yard line. McClanahan with the tackle.
You know, that's really a great stat, the graphic that was just up there. They threw 12 interceptions out of 724 attempts in the regular season. That's 1 out of every 60, yet they've already thrown 6 in the playoffs.
And the big one coming when Doug Flutie threw 4.
Good block by Drummond out front. Look how strong Michael Pringle is. He's only 195 pounds, but constantly running through tackle.
Picked up 8. First down. Bootleg. Ham. Dumps it off to Skinny Culver, but he can't hold on to it. Marvin Coleman covering for Calgary. So far, Mike Pringle has rushed the ball 18 times for 95 yards now. The Stallions are 17-1 whenever Pringle rushes for 100 yards or better.
And remember, this defense of Calgary only gives up an average of 55 yards rushing the entire game. Pringle almost doubling that by himself.
Second down and 10. Ball on the 40. Play action. Pam underneath to Armstrong. Gets a great block by Drummond. But it does not look like he'll pick up the first down. Chris Armstrong sliding down about a yard shy of the first down.
Gus, I thought the same thing you did. When Drummond made the block, I thought he was going to get to the corner. Crossing route. Good call. Ham hits him right there in the hands. Block right there on McClanahan. I thought he had it made. And once again, the slippery turf, feet come out under him. That's a key play right there.
Third down and short, and Stallions, they're going to go for it, relying on that big offensive line of theirs.
That and the one-yard neutral rule.
And Robert Drummond jumps off sides, and the drive will end here.
Illegal procedure, Baltimore number 2. 5-yard penalty, third down.
Critical mistake by Robert Drummond that will force them to punt the football right here in front of you. Number 2, Drummond. Play was on 3, he went on 2. And to make matters worse, now he's got to go cover the kick.
So Josh Miller will send it away from his 30, and he gets off a beautiful punt, but the wind just takes it over. Here's Coleman at the 30, picking his way upfield, finally goes down at the 32-yard line. Flags have been thrown on the play. This will be a no-yield.
Yeah, they're going to get Charles Anthony. We talked at the very beginning of the program, the wind on the punt returns, the cover team's got to be cognizant also of the ball being knocked down by the wind.
Stampeders.
No yards. Baltimore number 9. 15-yard penalty. First down.
Charles Anthony.
Now that's the second time Baltimore has been called for a 15-yard, no yards penalty. And on the other hand, Stampeders have committed the same penalty and have only been flagged for 5 yards. First down and 10. Flutie to Stewart out of the backfield. He'll get up to midfield. Chased out of bounds by Matt Goodwin.
We're down to 3 minutes and 43 seconds. Flutie knows he's got to get the football vertically down the field at this point.
Gain of 8, second down and 2. Here's Stewart again. Close to the first down. Clock continues to run. O.J. Brigance, middle linebacker, making the tackle for the Stallions. He's turned out a solid game, especially with the block punt in the first half.
You know, Gus, we talked at the beginning about Don Matthews and how he built this club. Let's listen to him.
Well, when we put this team together as an expansion team, we were able to choose our players and body types just exactly how we wanted them. So what we did was we used Calgary as an example of, let's defend Calgary with the type of athletes we need. Therefore, we have guys like Tracy Gravely and Matt Goodwin playing linebackers. They're defensive backs playing linebackers. So we match up very, very well speed-wise, but they were our target team when we put this football team together. So it couldn't be a better matchup for our defense.
Pretty interesting tape, huh?
No question.
2 years ago, built for this game.
Third down and 1. Flutie submarining ahead, and he picks up the first down. And you talk about guys like Matt Goodwin, Tracy Gravely, O.J. Brigance, who has 10 tackles in this game, started off as defensive lineman.
As far as I'm concerned, those three linebackers, Gravely, Brigance, and Goodwin, all of them could play strong safety. They have that kind of natural ability.
First down from the 53. Time running out on the Stampeders. Stewart with the reception, but he gets nailed. Irv Smith with the hit on Tony Stewart.
Baltimore doing a good job mixing up coverages.
We're at the 3-minute warning. Calgary in troubling 34-20 in the Great Cup. Baltimore left in the 83rd Grey Cup. Baltimore hanging on to a 34-20 lead over the Calgary Stampeders. Baltimore has beaten every team in this league in their two-year existence except one, and that's the team they're facing right now, the Calgary Stamps.
I guarantee you that man right there, Jimmy Speros, will trade those two regular season losses for a Grey Cup win any day of the week. Look at him. He played at Clemson. He was a linebacker at Clemson when they won the national championship in 1981. Then he played for Montreal for two seasons before becoming a defensive coach with the Washington Redskins. The reason I like that guy, he's a football guy before a business guy. He cares.
Second down and 8 from the 51. Here's Flutie over the middle, complete, but Allen Pitts, he gets punished and drops the football. That's Matt Goodwin delivering the hammer.
That was also Ken Benson. It was Goodwin and Benson. And Allen Pitts gave it up.
Head starting to drop on the Calgary sideline. 2:48 left. Second down. Third down, rather, and 8 from the 52. Here's Flutie, and he has it deflected at the line of scrimmage, and that's Elfrid Payton once again.
The Terminator.
Elfrid Payton. And the Stampeders turn the ball over on down. Just has not been their day.
Number 56, 18 sacks. If you can't get there, get the hand up. And that's as big a play as there is in football right there. Stopping them on downs. Baltimore's ball.
For Payton, this is the fourth straight year that he's played in the Grey Cup. And he may take a ring home this evening. Play action. Ham. Scrambling. Goes down at the 52.
That was play action to run the whole way. Now this whole Baltimore group, I'm so impressed with, starting with Speros, who had the forethought to hire a football guy with experience in the CFL like Don Matthews. Matthews then went out and brought in not only his own staff, but also many players that were all CFL in this league under him in Saskatchewan and BC.
In what could possibly be their last year in Baltimore, the Stallions. Mike Pringle, he's got room. Mike Pringle sprinting towards the end zone, goes down inside the 20-yard line. First down, gain of 37 for the CFL's most outstanding player.
That's like dotting the I at Ohio State right here. The cutback by Pringle. Look at the strength at 195 pounds running through the tackle of Alondra Johnson. This guy's pretty special. As Gus said a little while ago, Baltimore 17-1, and it just happened. 19 carries for 132 yards.
First down from the 18. Here's Pringle again. Stacked up at the 15-yard line, and there's so many interesting stories surrounding this game with Baltimore probably playing their last year in the city of Baltimore with an NFL team coming to town.
And you know, and that's a shame. They've got 30,000 loyal fans that come out every week to watch them play. They've really got a foothold in that Baltimore area.
When they first began playing, they were the horse with no name. Now they're the team with no home. Here's Pringle down to the 10-yard line.
One other thing they are, Gus, and that's Grey Cup champions.
And that is, there is no question about that. A minute, 23 seconds left. Up 34-20. They have come out here in the second half and just completely dominated Calgary. Regardless of the wind or the field conditions or playing on foreign soil, it has not mattered. These guys have been focused from the first day of practice this season and especially at the beginning of this week.
You said it well earlier, Gus, and that is that just getting here wasn't enough for Baltimore this year. Sometimes you have to taste defeat before you can appreciate victory.
talked to Don Matthews during the season, and he told me that he was not able to watch the Grey Cup tape of their loss last year to BC until about halfway through the season when they were getting ready to face BC once again.
It's a bitter pill to swallow.
Here's Huerta, 4 of 6 on the day. A little chippy, and it's good. And they should be celebrating in Baltimore because the Stallions are going to be Grey Cup champions.
You know, I had a chance to talk with Don Matthews yesterday, and I asked him, what are the 3 things you got to do to beat Calgary tomorrow?
Well, I think we've got to establish the run, and Calgary's got a good run defense, but we think we've got a good scope on them, and we certainly established the run. 2, we can't turn the ball over, especially in our end, but we cannot turn the ball over. And 3, we need a big play out of Chris Ryden special teams.
And they've got it all. They've got it all. Underneath, complete, Alec Vince.
If I'm sitting there with a little marker next to that, I'm saying establish the run, check. Turnovers, well, we had 1 or 2 early, but check. And lastly, special teams, big check, dominated by Baltimore.
28-yard game for Alan Pitts, maybe a little too late. First down from the Stallions, 47. Here's Flutie. Firing it downfield, wide open receiver, and he can't get it to him. More pressure put on him by Grant Carter.
Not enough has been made about Grant Carter. He's had an excellent year, very quietly, 6 sacks, a couple fumble recoveries, and what they tell me, he's just a smart player, very quick, really became the glow of this defensive line. These guys are just playing for pride now. Gets off the block, puts the big hit on Flutie. How many times in that one series do you think they grabbed each other's face mask off?
As you take a look at the Calgary sideline, Jeff Garcia, the backup quarterback, has to only sit back and wonder what if he would have gotten an opportunity. Indicative of the night for Calgary, Alan Pitts unable to hang on to the football.
Well, we've just been told and just been notified that Tracy Ham is the most valuable player of the game. There's Michael Pringle, who had a heck of a game, in my opinion. And also, David Sapungis, as you see the pass drop by Pitts right there. David Sapungis was named most outstanding Canadian. He had 7 catches for 84 yards.
The Baltimore Stallions have come into Taylor Field. Maybe 1,000 people rooting for him here. And they have done the job underneath again. Sapungis at the 20-yard line, 50 seconds left. 30-yard pickup.
Finally starting to find his favorite route, which is the seam pass. But what's happened is Baltimore's just playing a soft zone, letting him throw the football.
Again, complete at the 6-yard line. That's Tyrone Williams. First catch of the game for him.
He's going to be a good football player. He's got a nice future ahead of him.
And look at that guy.
That's become your most outstanding offensive lineman.
I don't want a beer.
If he wants a beer, he's in the right country.
No question about it, and I'm sure he'll put down a couple before this evening is over.
Man.
Here's Flutie. Thrown in the end zone, incomplete. Terry Vaughn just couldn't hang on, and with 23 seconds left.
Well, I think in one play is a synopsis of the evening right there. Terry Vaughn with the drop touchdown pass. How about our boy Mike Withycombe, though? He might be tasting some champagne before he gets a beer. What do you think?
Yeah, there's no question about it. Champagne out of the cup.
Great year again for Calgary, only to end bitter disappointment.
Stampeders may have come into this game a little too confident. Firing underneath, incomplete. Flutie going down once again. Grant Carter with the pressure.
It's third down. We're still on the clock.
And here's Don Matthews. He gets the Gatorade shower. As he shakes hands with his quarterback, Tracy Ham. The brain trust there.
The Gatorade shower popularized Bill Parcells and the Giants in the mid-80s. Jimmy Burt dumping it on the Super Bowl.
18 ticks remaining. Flutie in trouble. Rolling. Lets it go into the end zone. Incomplete. Allen Pitts, the intended receiver, and his former teammate is all in his face. Doug Kraft. And the Stampeders will turn the ball over on downs. And there you have it. Jimmy Speros and the Baltimore Stallions and Don Matthews have 9 seconds standing in the way of their first Grey Cup and only their second season in the Canadian Football League.
Jimmy Speros, number one. Give some credit to Darryl Adralin, the linebacker and special teams coach. His special teams, in my opinion, took the heart out of this Calgary team.
Tracy Ham will line up and take a knee. Eight seconds left, 37-20. And that is your ball game. For the first time in the 106-year history, Canadian Football League, an American team will claim the Grey Cup. Let's go downstairs where Lisa Bowles is in the middle of all the pandemonium.
Thanks very much, guys. Mike Pringle. Mike, how satisfying is this, especially after last year?
Oh, I couldn't ask for anything better. A victory in the style that we did it, our offense, our defense, special teams, everybody came to play. I love it. The Grey Cup is coming over on the other side of the border, but we're going to take real good care of it.
Thanks very much, Mike.
Thank you.
Mike Pringle, 139 yards rushing, and I guess he summed it up. The Grey Cup will be going south of the border and will reside in the city of Baltimore for at least 1 year. And there's a man, Don Matthews, the architect of this system.
Been a heck of a week for Mike Pringle. Most outstanding player in the league, wins the Grey Cup. And he's up for a contract negotiation this offseason, so good timing.
And the Cup is heading back to the States as this Baltimore team, for the second straight year, advances to the Cup, and this year they win it. Let's go back downstairs to Lisa Bowles.
Okay, Carl Anthony, how satisfying is this, especially after all the team's been through?
No, we waited a year with the disappointing loss at BC. We came back, we knew we was playing against a great team. We knew the weather might have played a little factor, but we said if we can get on top of them and let Mike Pringle run the ball, we'll be successful.
Outstanding job shutting down Calgary's big, potent offense, and especially the receivers in the two slots.
Yeah, the thing we try to do is try to be physical with them, because during the year we see that the team that played physical against them, they won. So we try to come out, play a little physical, try to get them out their rhythm, try to make Doug Flutie run around a little bit, and then eventually try to just do a little, just throw the ball away.
No question, unfinished business has been completed.
That's right, unfinished business, baby. CFL is the greatest. Canadian Football League, baby. Number one, baby. Number one.
Thanks, Carl. Guys.
Thank you, Lisa. For Don Matthews, the seventh time he's won a Grey Cup. Won a Grey Cup as a head coach with BC, also with the Saskatchewan Rough Riders right here in Regina, and now with the Baltimore Stallions. Let's go back down to Lisa.
Thanks very much, Gus. Alfred Payton, how satisfying is this?
Oh, it's real satisfying. I've been saying all week long, they can't block us up front. They cannot block us up front. We blow them off the ball, and it was all the Canada talking about Calgary, this Calgary, but Baltimore, we had the best team. And I want you to know, Baltimore, we're bringing it home, baby. We're bringing it home to you, baby. That's our cup. That's our cup.
The swag dog was all over Flutie. You talked about week. You did the job.
I felt that was really important to get the Flutie, and that's what we was able to do to get him off stride. And keep him out the park, keep him in the pocket, and keep him from getting on his rhythm. I felt it was really important to hit it, to keep hitting him, baby. And I'm glad we got to bring it on home.
Well, I know personally you're excited about a Grey Cup because you haven't seen one in a while.
Oh, yeah. Well, I have lost three. But this, how sweet it is. It's so sweet. It's so, now I'm going home. I'm going home now.
Thanks very much, Alfred. Now let's go to the presentation of the cup and the most outstanding player.
There it is, Lord Grey's Cup, which will be presented to the Baltimore Stallions in only their second year of existence in the Canadian Football League. And it's a trophy that this team has worked their tails off for, led by that man.
Peyton really made a good point. He said, I wanted to get Flutie off stride. You don't always have to get sacks. You just have to get enough pressure to force the quarterback to do some things with no timing. And that's what they were able to do today. Interesting call on the most outstanding player. Tracy Ham had a great game, but he certainly should give half of it to that tailback lining up behind him, Michael Pringle. Tracy Ham was 17 for 29, 227 yards. Also had a rushing touchdown. Michael Pringle broke the 100-yard barrier yet again. Kenny Watson did a great job in the secondary today on the slot backs.
There you take a look at Ham, who won a Grey Cup in Saskatchewan, but was a backup quarterback at that time. This is the first time he's won the cup as a starting quarterback. As they get ready to present the trophy to the Baltimore Stallions. That's Larry Smith. Presenting the trophy to the Baltimore Stallions. For the first time in the 106-year history of the Canadian Football League, the Grey Cup will be residing in the United States as the Baltimore Stallions go on to beat the Calgary Stampeders by a score of 37-20. They were 15-3 during the regular season, perfect in the playoffs, and they'll go home with the trophy.
We ought to thank everyone we've worked with all year. Steve Walshay in the truck, our producer, statistician, spotsman, everybody.
For Mike Mayock, I'm Gus Johnson, saying so long from Regina.
20. Carlos Huerta had a big game as well. What a great year he had. 5 field goals on the night. This from 18 yards out that made the final 37-20. And for the Stallions, a 13th straight victory. Unreal. The first CFL team to ever reach the 18-win mark in one season. But more importantly, sweet revenge for last year's Grey Cup defeat at the hands of the BC Lions. After NFL and USFL titles, Baltimore becomes the first city to claim championships in 3 pro football leagues now. The Baltimore Stallions, champions of the CFL.
I want to say this, Don Matthews, the coaching staff, the players, they're the reason we're here. They're the champions. We're number one, Grey Cup, first time ever.
Hey, my teammates, we've been together all year, and it's a group effort, and, you know, what a ball game.
You know, we got the victory. We beat the best. You know, it was the best against the best. And we beat the best, so that makes us undoubtedly the best team in the CFL.
All right, joining us live now from Regina, Saskatchewan, is cornerback Irv Smith. What an unbelievable game for the Stallions tonight. Irv, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, I can.
All right, Irv, tell me about the game tonight. I know that you guys expected a tough game from Calgary, but really you dominated from start to finish.
Well, I wouldn't say we dominated, but it was closer than what the score really showed. I mean, I take my hat off to Doug Doug led his team as best as he could, but our defense, you know, we took the challenge and we contained them, and we bent, but we didn't break.
Hey, Irv, Bruce Cunningham here. Congratulations.
How you doing, Bruce?
I tell you something, you and me, we've taken a lot of plane rides these last 2 years, and wouldn't you know it, the first game I miss is the one where you win the Grey Cup championship. What about luck? I tell you something, though. They were favored going in. They figured they were the best team in the CFL. They knew that Baltimore had never beat them. You guys had a lot to prove today in that game, didn't you?
Oh, yeah. We stayed focused, you know, with all the things going around with Cleveland and being up here with Grey Cup week. And Saskatchewan put on a great Grey Cup all week long. I mean, there was a lot of festivities. The fans were really into it. But we just stayed focused, you know, and Coach Matthews gave us an 11 o'clock curfew starting on Tuesday, so we didn't have any choice but to stay focused.
Irv, 2 years, two straight years going to the Grey Cup, the second year you actually win it. What are your feelings now as compared to last year?
This is like a bittersweet victory. I mean, last year I can remember sitting in the locker rooms, replaying certain plays in my head, and the kick that beat us in the last seconds, you know, it really haunted me all off season. But now, since we're champions, it's really hadn't sunk into me yet, but it's going to sink into me tonight and tomorrow on a plane ride home, and I'm sure when we get to the pep rally tomorrow, hopefully the city will turn out and show its support for us.
Well, Irv, you said it hasn't sunk in yet, but is it as sweet as you thought it would be?
Oh, yeah, and then some. You know, I'm sure I'm upstairs at the little party that we're having now, victory party, and everybody's just flying around and having fun, and this is the way it's supposed to be. This is the way football is supposed to be played. And, you know, I'm surrounded by a bunch of great football players, and now we all culminated, and we won the victory today.
Well, no one knows what the future will bring, Irv, but I tell you one thing, the city of Baltimore sure is happy tonight. Congratulations on behalf of everybody here.
Thank you.
We'll see you tomorrow.
Great job, Irv. You know what? Truly a tip of the cap, because so many people talked about, could this team overcome the distraction? You know, you've seen a Baltimore, rather a Cleveland Browns team that has not been able to overcome that distraction.
Exactly.
This team rises up. These guys don't know where they're going to be next year. They rise up. They step up. They beat Calgary. They beat Doug Flutie. They do it in a hostile environment. Really just an incredible sporting achievement, I think.
You know, you look way back when they lost to Memphis here in Baltimore. It seems like 3 years ago. The last game they won, they just kept getting better and better and better. And really, the oddsmakers didn't give them a chance to win this game. They were underdogs going in, but all they did was go out and prove who the best team in the CFL is, and to do it winning 13 in a row. It's unbelievable. It's amazing. And if this team does go away, what a great memory, what a great note for them to leave.
Ironic. Obviously, the fact that they're going to end up leaving has nothing to do with them, but it's amazing to see a championship team, better than everybody else.
We want to pass along, too, that while they get back at the airport at 1:30, it's going to be in the private area of the airport. We do not suggest you go out there, but at 2:30 tomorrow, write this down, 2:30 at the Inner Harbor, a special welcome home rally for the Baltimore Stallions. Anyone who's ever been a Stallion fan, go down to the Inner Harbor tomorrow at 2:30, and let's tell them thank you en masse, as they say.
Stallions are worthy of the attention, a phenomenal achievement, second-year franchise.
You can't do what they did. You can't do it. No, you can't go to the Grey Cup your first year, and then you win it your second year. It's unbelievable.
Get out there. All right, Pizza Hut trivia time now. We're looking
team with Mike Pringle, and if the Calgary Stampeders tried to put the ball up with Flutie, they wouldn't be able to do it, at least during half the game when they were going against the wind, and it turned out that was exactly what the case was. As we said at the top, the Baltimore Stallions are the Grey Cup champions. They completed the mission they set for themselves when training camp began way back in the summer. Make it to the Grey Cup and this time win it. The Baltimore Stallions, the first American team to win Canada's Grey Cup. In the win, in fact, was a big factor. This game gusts up to 60 miles an hour. The Stallions shot Calgary with a big first punt of the game. Chris Wright on one bounce at the 28. He gets through the first wave of tacklers. He's up over midfield. He's running like a man possessed. He'll take it back a record 82 yards for the touchdown. And just like that, the Stallions were up 7-0. But Calgary would not go away easily. In the second quarter, Stallions up 7-6. Doug Flutie from the 2-yard line, play action, roll out, throws to Marvin Popey, just as inbounds. Stampeders take their only lead of the game, 13-7. Late second quarter, 13-10 Calgary. They're back to punt. O.J. Brigance works through to block the punt. The ball's rolling towards the end zone, being chased down by four Stallions, and it's Alvin Walton who runs it down the end zone. Stallions back on top, 23-13. They led 23-13 at the half.
Third quarter, Calgary cut the lead to 24-20. Tracy Ham from the 13. In all kinds of trouble, and how does he get out of this? This is where he makes his money, folks. He scampers in 13 yards for the major. Stallions up 31-20. Then in the fourth quarter, the defense came up big. Flutie driving the Calgary Stampeders, throws the ball. It's picked off by Charles Anthony. That sealed up the victory. Stallions win it 37-20. They are the 1995 Grey Cup champions.
Two postseason playoff wins.
You know, we got the victory. We beat the best. You know, it was the best against the best. And we beat the best, so that makes us undoubtedly the best team in the CFL.
What a ball game. It's hard to describe because the ball game was such a well-played ball game. Calgary, you take your hats off to them. They have some great players. And, you know, we played well today, and that's why we won.
We knew from the very beginning of training camp that we had to win the Grey Cup. Because I remember that bitter taste from last year. What a terrible feeling it was to lose that Grey Cup. And we said from the very beginning, anything less than a Grey Cup championship is going to be a disappointing season.
It's not like we were supposed to come in here and walk all over these guys. They're a good football team. Give them credit.
We came here, nobody like us, but we going out of here. You can't do nothing but love us.
Chris Armstrong looking for a little love from the Stallions faithful. Armstrong and the Grey Cup champion Stallions will be back in the Inner Harbor for a victory celebration tomorrow. That should kick off at around 2:30. With the National Football League, the Browns haven't won a game since the word came out they were moving to Baltimore, but at least today they got the ball in the end zone. Coach Bill Belichick has lots to worry about, a struggling offense and defense, and then there were upset fans who booed the home team today. All Green Bay Packers first half.
The City of Champions, and there's an excellent reason to add to that, because right in our studios tonight, we have the Grey Cup, the Canadian Football League Grey Cup. Our Baltimore Stallions won the cup last night. It was a great game. Sports Director Scott Garceau joins us now with the cup and a very happy owner. Scotty?
You're right, Stan. For the first time in 83 years of the Grey Cup, Lord Earl Grey's crossed the border and passed through customs today. Jim Speros was in charge. Congratulations.
Thank you, Scott.
It's nice to have it here in the States, isn't it?
It certainly is.
They give you any trouble at customs bringing it in?
Well, I tell you what, they weren't too happy when we crossed the border today, but I can tell you one thing. He didn't get much sleep last night.
How about the warm reception you got? The team stopped coming back home today at the Inner Harbor. We've got some video of the rally down there. Your most loyal fans were all on hand. They must made you and the team feel
They did a great job. I want to say thank you to Len Burrow, the big wheel, and Lucy Kelly, the special teamers, put everything together and got all these fans down the first day. It was a very warm reception, and our fans were here to greet these guys. You know something? Yeah, these guys are champions, Scott, and they did a great job last night.
And Mayor Schmoke actually drank champagne out of the Grey Cup, I saw it.
Well, that's right. He did take a sip of the champagne. But
there he goes.
Rightfully so. It's been a long haul for our organization. In 2 years, we've made history.
Let me ask you, tomorrow you meet with Governor Glenn Denning. There's still a big question mark where this team's going to be. I know your fans want you here in Baltimore. What's it going to take specifically from the governor of the state to keep you here, Jim?
Well, I'll tell you what, Scott. We have a chance to sit down with the governor and discuss our future tomorrow, and that's what we're going to do. I want to be here, and you know, specifically, I can't really go over too many details, but I'll just say this, is that we feel there's a financial obligation that's got to be made because the NFL is coming to Baltimore. If the NFL wasn't coming to Baltimore, as a businessman, I would take on the personal challenges of selling season tickets and corporate sponsorships, but this is certainly hindered our opportunity, and I want to sit down with the governor and find out how the state and the city can work together to secure our financial success for the future, because I think we deserve it. These guys deserve the best. We've put a championship product on the field. I think we're good for the community. We're heavily involved here, and I want to stay. So I would think that this town and this state wants to keep a champion.
And certainly the momentum coming off the Grey Cup and bringing this prize home isn't going to hurt matters. But no matter what happens in the future, I know I speak for all sports fans in Baltimore. Congratulations. Everybody
Thank you,
was proud of you and your team
great,
yesterday.
Great. Thank
Give them a hand. All right. Okay. We're going to take this out dancing tonight, and we'll see you a little later in sports.
Okay.
By the way,
can I borrow that and put it on my mantle for about a week? Real impressive.
On the front of your Cadillacs.
My gremlin, you mean. Well, as you might guess, the Stallions' victory is not exactly playing well in Canada right now.
That's right, Jim. I don't know if you know this, but the front of the Calgary Sun reads, "It's a gray day for Canada, eh?" Most of the Calgary players interviewed feel they let Canada down. That was a sentiment captured by the Toronto Sun. Kiss your cup goodbye, Canada. Oh, well.
What can we
say? Glad to have it. And it's really beautiful. Oh. I don't know if you can tell on TV, but to see it in person, you can see the history behind it.
I've seen a couple of Super Bowl trophies, and I like that one better. I really do.
It's gorgeous.
Yeah, it has a lot of history to it also. Mm-hmm. All right.
Well, we had a pretty warm day outside considering what we've had in the past couple of days. I understand changes are coming.
Meteorologist.
About those Stallions. That was so much fun to watch yesterday on ESPN2. It was a great game, and congratulations. First team in the States to ever win that cup.
And a meteoric rise when you consider the last, you know, their first year, they're the most successful expansion franchise in professional sports history, and this year they win the whole banana, and then, you know, the punchline is they got to go.
Yeah, but they're going to be very valuable, aren't they? A franchise, any city would want them.
I would think, and you know, the one point that's been made that I don't know if it's viable or not, but it's at least something to think about, is if the Bowie Bay Sox can survive that close,
right,
to an Orioles franchise, which does gangbusters, why can't a CFL team survive someplace else? Obviously, Memorial Stadium would be a conflict while the Browns are here, but why couldn't they survive somewhere else in the vicinity?
Good question.
Yeah. Anyway, 1 year ago, the Charm City CFLers did become the most successful expansion team in the history of pro sports. Now, they are in their second year of existence, and they have managed to do what no other American-based team has ever done before, that being to bring the Grey Cup south of the border. Over 50,000 people were there to watch the Stallions and the Calgary Stampeders at Taylor Field in Saskatchewan first quarter. Chris Wright fields a punt at his own 28 for the Stallions. Juke step back up the middle. Nobody's home. He busts it, untouched, 82 yards for the touchdown. 7-0, Stallions take the lead and go on for a 17-point winner. 37-20 was the final count. They finish their season with 13 consecutive wins. They finish with a record of 18-3, and they are the Grey Cup champions, having beaten Calgary and Doug Flutie 37-20. Pat Warren is down at the Inner Harbor Amphitheater, where there was a big welcome home rally for the Stallions earlier today. She's cold, so let's get right to her. Pat.
Well, thank you for that, John. I heard you and Richard discussing whether or not the Baltimore CFL Stallions could stay. There was some discussion about that today. We may be getting an answer soon. The mayor wants them to stay. Jim Speros wants the team to stay. The team wants to stay. The fans want to stay. Everybody wants to stay. And about 500 people were here at the Inner Harbor Amphitheater to welcome the Grey Cup Stallions home. There was no lack of enthusiasm, as you can hear, either. The Stallions' win makes Baltimore the only city to hold three football championships, the NFL, the USFL, and now the CFL. Fans were also quick to point out that Jim Speros brought us a team when no one else wanted us, and now he's brought us a champion. It hasn't been lost on the mayor. He says he wants to keep them here.
I have a sense that it could work, that we could have the Browns here and the Stallions. A little bit difference in schedule, great deal difference in price, and I think we could have hardcore fans for both of them.
Absolute record breaker. I mean, they have only been in existence 2 years, and they've broken every CFL record you can possibly think of, from rushing to consecutive win games to who knows what. I mean, these guys are absolutely great. They love this town. They love these fans. They want to stay, and we want them to be here.
We did our job. We made it to the mountaintop. We brought the Grey Cup back to Baltimore in 2 years.
Oh, yeah!
Now it's Baltimore's turn to make sure we stay here.
We're going to hear more from Jim Speros and about his intentions to try to get the team to stay in Baltimore, John, at 6.
All right, Pat, thank you very much. I know Speros has a meeting with the governor tomorrow. Is he at all optimistic about that particular encounter?
He was extremely optimistic. As a matter of fact, he says that they really think they can work something out about keeping the team here. And one other thing, you mentioned Memorial Stadium and the fact that there could be a conflict in the schedule between the Stallions and the Browns. The mayor mentioned that there's going to be renovations at Memorial Stadium, and there may be problems for those 2 years, but then the Browns are supposed to be out of there in a new stadium, and Memorial Stadium will be available again.
Yeah, okay. Pat Warren, thanks to you very much. We'll check back with you at the top of the 6 o'clock. That's Pat Warren reporting from downtown as the new Grey Cup champion, the CFLers, the Stallions, receive a hero's welcome back here in Charm City this afternoon. We'll be back with sports a little bit later. The turnaround on the field, incidentally, they sort of did an estimate on that to get it from an NFL configuration to a CFL configuration or vice versa would be 72 hours. So it would be very, very difficult for them to coexist.
Mm. Right, in the same place. Yeah. All right, well, thanks. That's great, though. They're thinking about it.
Still ahead of us on Eyewitness News at 5 tonight.
What?
MOP in Canada.
What is an MOP?
Most outstanding player.
Oh, isn't that
I'm sorry.
Nice.
All right.
It's okay. Give me 10 push-ups. We'll call it even.
You got it.
Right. 83rd edition of the CFL's Grey Cup Championship game turned out to be a historic contest. Stallions went up against Doug Flutie and the Calgary Stampeders on a cold and gusty day in Saskatchewan. Calgary fans doing that Molson thing, eh? All fired up. Stamps led 13-10 second quarter. Stallions come up on special teams. O.J. Brigance in, blocks the punt. Stallions run it down. Alvin Walton scoops it up, rolls into the end zone for the touchdown. Stallions lead 17-13, never trailed from that point on. Third quarter, Stallions still up by four from the Calgary 13-yard line. Ham takes a look, nothing there. Takes another look, nothing there. He's still looking. He's stepping out. He's got room to run. Tracy Ham's going to do it all by his lonesome. In for the touchdown, made it 31-20. Stallions, the final was 37-20. Stallions are the Grey Cup champions. Ham, the game's most outstanding player, but said later that that title could have gone any number of different directions.
You could have gone to any number of players and said, here's the MVP. And, you know, it was a group effort and just, you know, individual awards, you know, is not who I am because it's a team game.
Tracy Ham and those Grey Cup champion Stallions, now in all likelihood a team without a city. With the Browns coming in, Stallions almost certainly going to have to move out at least somewhere. Stallions frontman Jim Speros scheduled to meet with the governor tomorrow to see if there's any way that the state will help make it possible for them to stay in the immediate area somehow. That, however, is not at this point considered to be too likely. And that's a quick hit on sports for five. More coming back on Eyewitness News at 6. Have more from the Stallions and show you the Browns' latest debacle, along with bringing you some of the high points from week number 12 in the National Football League. Have all that and the rest of the day in sports coming back in about 50 minutes on Eyewitness News
at 6 o'clock.
And in about two, getting it tonight, I bet.
They'll sleep the sleep of champions tonight. Yeah, so many questions about the future, but the Stallions are the answer to the question, who's the first team in the 103-year history of the CFL to take the Grey Cup out of Canada? The Cup arrived in Baltimore mid-afternoon, and Mike Pringle held it high as the Stallions were greeted by some of their diehard fans at an Inner Harbor rally. Tomorrow, Jim Speros meets with Governor Glenn Denning about the team's future. Tonight at 5, the owner brought the cup here and told me he's not ready to run out of town yet.
If the NFL wasn't coming to Baltimore as a businessman, I would take on the personal challenges of selling season tickets and corporate sponsorships. But this has certainly hindered our opportunity, and I want to sit down with the governor and find out how the state and the city can work together to secure our financial success for the future, because I think we deserve it. These guys deserve the best. We've put a championship product on the field. I think we're good for the community. We're heavily involved here, and I want to stay. So I would think that this town and this state wants to keep a champion.
And later on in sports, we'll hear from head coach Don Matthews and star running back Mike Pringle. The Stallions are the champions of the CFL, no matter where they are next year.
But I hope it's viable that they can stay.
That meeting with the governor, I think more and more people are starting to think maybe this can work. Let's try it for a year at least. We'll see.
Well, certainly the win has given them some extra momentum.
Yeah.
Thanks, Scott. Right, see you soon. For Beatles fans. But now moving on to happier times.
Moving on to happier times. You know, Baltimore has not had a good tradition for keeping its trophies around when they've won football championships.
Well, this one will be here for at least 6 months, right?
Right. We had our picture taken with it today. Several employees.
Remember it well.
Madam Ram, a little history here. Madam Ram, Georgia Franiere, took Baltimore's Super Bowl V trophy out of town. Miles Tannenbaum took Baltimore's USFL trophy back home to Philadelphia. But the Grey Cup is in Baltimore now, and Mayor Schmoke sampled the sweet taste of victory. Stallions' first U.S. team to ever win Canada's football prize. Mike Pringle and Carlos Huerta may go to the NFL, and the Stallions may go to Timbuktu, but today these guys came home CFL champs.
We had a slogan after we lost our last game to Memphis. We said, no reason for us to lose another football game. The players bought into it. They didn't lose another game. And now what we're saying is, there's no reason not to win another cup.
With what you've done the last 2 years, you may have some other opportunities. Have you given that much thought?
I'm listening to everybody. So my first interest is going to be with this organization. I'm going to listen to see what Jim Spiros has to say, and hopefully we can come to some type of agreement.
You want to give that thing a kiss? You kissed it a few times?
Yeah.
All right.
That cup's getting worn out. Tomorrow, Jim Speros and Governor Glenn Denning talk about the Stallions' future in Annapolis. Legal proceedings on the Browns' move to Baltimore continue tomorrow morning in Cleveland, with testimony expected from jilted Mayor Michael White. Today, a lawyer for Art Modell insisted it's over. The Browns are moving to Baltimore, period. The only question is when. The judge has issued an order barring the Browns from making an immediate move to Baltimore, at least until that hearing ends. Monday Night Ball, you see.
When it's 120 degrees on the track and it feels like 300 in the suit, there's only one way to drink the Coca-Cola 1 liter. Ice cold and inverted. Need a pit stop? Grab the 1 liter in the genuine Coca-Cola bottle. To win the Winston Cup, you gotta eat, sleep, and drink racing. Well, eat and sleep racing anyway. Congratulations, Jeff.
Can McDonald's Chicken McNuggets make you feel like a kid again? Can they bring you closer together? Can they give you a thrill? Can they be just the break you've been waiting for? Of course they can. Can they make you see double? As a matter of fact, yes. With McDonald's 2 for $2, two tempting 6-piece Chicken McNuggets or two McChicken sandwiches for just $2. So, can they give two empty, unfulfilled hands something very entertaining to do? Absolutely.
Have you had your break today?
Excuse me? That's better. Excuse me? That's better. Excuse me? Excuse me. There's nothing better than a steak from Winn-Dixie.
Is this your idea of excitement? Let me tell you about exciting, okay? Driving around a racetrack at over 200 miles an hour, that's exciting. These are just flakes.
Well, what do you think?
These are really good. They're crispy, too.
Really?
Yeah, they're mighty good even with nothing on them. What are they?
Hey, Charlie.
Yeah. Kellogg's Corn Flakes? How could I be so dumb?
You got 3 miles to think about it.
Kellogg's is proud to sponsor NASCAR champion Terry Labonte.
Back at Atlanta Motor Speedway, where the race has been concluded, Dale Earnhardt wins the race. There is the 95 NASCAR Winston Cup champion, Jeff Gordon. He's currently on the back of a big hauler that will carry him around the racetrack to the delight, I'm sure, of all the fans that have gathered here. Quite a mob scene down there here on the start-finish line and in victory lane. Here's Bill Weber.
Now on a day where we've crowned a series champion and a race champion, here's a true champion. What a great day. Thanks for the thrills, Ernie.
Well, I tell you, thanks for all the fan support and, the people that believed in Ernie Irvin, like Robert Yates and all the people at Texaco and Ford and, all the people that's been associated with enabling me to come back. And, I owe all that to them because couldn't have done it without all these people.
Tell us about your day out on this tough track.
I tell you, it's awful fast at this place, and the day was pretty uneventful. We started somewhat in the back and moved our way up, and everything went good. Todd made some great calls in the pits, and had the chassis really good. We just obviously Earnhardt had us all covered, so we were a second or third or fourth place car, and we ended up having to stop for fuel, but that's part of it.
Yeah, you can lift weights, but you can't take that Ford out and drive it around the block to get in shape. How about physically today for you?
It was definitely a little bit strenuous. I got a little bit tired, and that probably hindered me at the end. And it's just a matter of going to work even harder during the winter, and get in better shape. And you just can't get in enough shape as far as, because you can't do what you can do in the race car.
It's a pleasure to stand here next to you. Congratulations on a great season.
Thank you.
Okay, that's Ernie Irvin, Jerry Punch with Rusty Wall.
Well, they're also happy over here in the Miller pits or Miller garage area. Rusty Wallace, a great run for you, third place finish.
Yeah, the car ran acceptable, really good today. I started out real loose. We kept working on it. We got it all adjusted in pretty good. And the car was pretty good at the end. Just need a little bit more speed, but I'm real happy with the team, man. They did a great job. We got all these new people, and it's the best crew I've ever had. Everybody's smiling, so it's great.
I got to ask you, people said when you had this mass exodus a few weeks ago, people leaving, going to other teams, this team was going to fall apart. But you guys have pulled together, and that's got to be a pretty good omen for 1996. 6.
Oh, man, it is. You know, sometimes things like that are a good thing, and it just really helped our team losing the people we lost because it just has made our team so strong, and everybody's smiling, but I'm pumped up about it. I can't wait for 96. We're making a lot more horsepower than we ever made. The crew's happier. But anyway, hey, the big deal today, we're carrying a number 24 in the back of our car for a boy named Travis Roy that was hurt in a hockey accident, paralyzed, and we really feel for him. And that's the reason we had the sticker in the back of the car. Roger Penske, Walt Zarnicky, and all of us had it on there for him. But it was a real tragedy for him, but for us, and we're real happy with the outcome, and real proud to show our new colors today.
New colors, and by the way, last night, thanks for joining us for that 38 special concert. What you don't know is after you left late in the concert, I interviewed a lady out front who was dancing and having a good time there, and that was your mom. She was enjoying 38 special.
She's a rocker, no doubt about it. She's a good one.
Once again, congratulations.
I'd like to thank all the fans for a great 95. I'm sorry we let them down early in the year, but we'll step it up for next year.
Hey, Rusty's back in 96. You can bet on it. Let's go to John Kernan.
Bob, standing by with Sterling. Marlon Sterling, a great run today. You move up to third in the points. Congratulations on that move.
Well, I tell you, we knew what we had to do when we come down here, and Mark runs awful good here. We just prepared the car the best we could, and the crew done a great job all year and all day today. And the car drove real good. We just had up for three car, man. He was gone, but if it fell out, we'd won, but it didn't.
What about this season you guys had? You started off winning the Daytona 500, chance at the points championships, and you had a little low spot. But you guys showed some strength here toward the end, didn't you?
Yeah, we have. We've had a real good car. I guess the baddest run all year was Phoenix, and was really disappointed there. But this is a new car. We're headed at Charlotte and run off a good for us, and we come back here and run off a good. So we're just building for next year. We're going to really try to work on a short track program, and I feel like that's where we got beat this year. And if we can improve as much this year as we did last year, maybe we'll win a championship. We sure try.
Now, to get back up into the third spot to finish out the year, what does that mean to you guys as far as building next year to try and win that championship?
Well, you know, we had a meeting right there before the race, and we just felt like it'd be a plus for us and kind of get the momentum going for next year. And we hadn't been to Talladega for 3 days getting ready for Daytona, and I tell you, it'd be tough to win a third, but yeah, these guys are really tough, and I love it, place. We're going to try to get it down there.
I'll tell you what, when they go to Speed Weeks in February down at Daytona, this team probably would be the one that everybody else is shooting to knock off that top spot, don't you think?
Wouldn't doubt it a bit. He's been so strong the last 2 years and already preparing for 1996, and that Daytona 500 is just a little bit more than 3 months away. We'll be right back with more of our post-race show from Atlanta Motor Speedway.
Now, an oil made just for your hard-working engine. 4x4 from Quaker State. Off-roading, extreme temperatures, towing and hauling. They all make your light truck or 4x4 work extra hard and could shorten its life. Why settle for a conventional car oil? Get 4x4 from Quaker State, the intelligent oil for hard-working engines.
Now, take home a legend. Get an authentic autographed Superstar lithograph, a $30 value, just $7.50. See details on cases of 4x4 at your local supplier.
There's no track in the world that's tougher on brakes than the one in Martinsville, Virginia. And when drivers take the green flag here, they all have one thing in common, the same brand of brakes. Because without them, you can't come down this straightaway at 120 miles an hour and still the turn. So which brand do the top drivers use to get them through 500 laps at Martinsville? Performance Friction Carbon Metallic. And we stock them at AutoZone.
Smaller electrodes, more power. More electrodes, faster start.
Suddenly, everybody has a new spark plug idea promising instant higher performance. But one new plug's idea is higher performance that lasts. Introducing Autolite Double Platinum. Platinum on both sides of the gap for faster starts and more power every time. Platinum to platinum firing for guaranteed peak performance, long after other ideas have peaked out. Autolite Platinum and now Autolite Double Platinum. More precious metal for your precious metal.
Man has always been fascinated with speed. But winning is more than a flash of speed. It's a measure of skill. A test of guts. That's why the true spirit of NASCAR lies not in the machine, but in the man who drives it. We're proud to be part of this great sport. Busch, the official beer of NASCAR.
Well, the big flatbed truck is making its way around Atlanta Motor Speedway now. There's Jeff and Brooke. A little champagne in hand, a big champagne spray from Jeff Gordon as he opened the cork here on the main straightaway. Now the unofficial results of the race. You can see the top five, the top 15, actually, as six cars were on the lead lap. Look at the excellent performance turned in today by Ward Burton, who finished in fifth position. Here's Bill.
And you picked up a win earlier in the season and a great run today, and you were just saying what a fantastic way to end the season. Congratulations.
Thanks a lot. I tell you what, I got a great team right here, and I'm just tickled to be a part of it. And I got the best sponsor in the garage of MBNA, and man, I don't even think we've reached their potential yet. That's the really exciting part of it.
Ward, you're going to Daytona tomorrow to test.
Yeah, we're going to test the new Pontiac, and so we'll be there Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, and we'll learn a lot. The Pontiac owners are meeting with NASCAR, Mr. France and all, and I'm sure they'll decide how they're going to have the car finalized sometime before we leave here.
Ward, how valuable has the transition period been here for you? You do start fresh with this team in 96, obviously knowing you can get to victory lane and can run strong on tough tracks like this one here in Atlanta.
It makes a lot of momentum for us. You know, the things that Bill are doing, the kind of support MBNA is giving the team. We're building 10 brand new cars. We're going into a new shop that's just like something that the Hendrixes or Richard Childress would be in. I mean, everything we're doing is closing the parity gap down those top five or six teams, and it's showing already.
Well, you missed a couple races, still finished 22nd. Congratulations to Ward Burton.
Thanks.
Let's go back up top.
Another team that should be very strong in 1996. Let's check out our post-race notes here. Dale Earnhardt did lead the most laps, 268. Can you believe that? Ward Burton did make the biggest move from 25th to 22nd in the points. Ricky Craven, our congratulations to him, the best finishing rookie, 30th. He's going to walk off with Rookie of the Year honors and the 21st win for Chevrolet this season. Here's Dr. Punch.
Well, I'm standing with a guy who finished sixth, so I'm standing with a whole group of Spencers here. This is Jimmy Spencer, left of your screen. Middle, that's Katrina. She's seven. And Jimmy Jr., he's nine. And Jimmy, hey, what a great run today for you guys. Finished sixth.
Thanks, Jerry. You know, the Smokin' Joe's guys worked real hard today. Worked hard all year long. You know, finally our program's where it needs to be. We ran really strong at Charlotte and had an air gun break on us. And then today we didn't have no misfortune. So we ended up sixth. We really felt that we had a top 10 car and we come home there. But now we've got to work a little bit harder this winter and try and get up a little bit further than sixth.
Most importantly, you cracked the top 25 in points. Get some of that bonus money.
Yeah, it's important when you go into Daytona next year. You get on all the plans and it helps the car owner, Travis, you know, pay for the tires and things like that. And you know, we're getting ready. We're building a brand new car for down there. We didn't make the Daytona 500, but that's not going to happen this year. And we're going to make the Daytona 500 this year. There's no question about it. We ran strong on the super speedways, and we're going to do some more testing on the short tracks this fall, this winter, I should say. And I'm really excited about next year. You know, we've got some more people coming on board. And T. Wayne, thanks, man. Been real supportive of our group, and if it wasn't for T. Wayne, I don't believe this thing would be going where it is, and I just thank him a lot for it.
Well, Jimmy's excited, and so are the kids, because they get Dad home now for a couple weeks. They're going on vacation. They haven't had one this year, so they're all happy. They're going to have Dad home and be able to play a while, Bob.
Have a great time. Sixth place finisher Jimmy Spencer. Dale Earnhardt wins the race, and he ends the season with his 10th straight top 10 finish. We'll be right back.
Pit Stop Souvenirs invites you to come by and see all the new designs and styles of your favorite driver's hats, shirts, jackets, and souvenirs. Why wait until you get to the track when you can shop at Pit Stop 6 days a week and talk a little racing, too? And don't forget, we have the area's best selection and inventory of collectible race cards, the hottest thing to hit the sports scene. Whether it's apparel or collectibles you're looking for, Pit Stop has it. Proudly serving race fans since 1991. Pit Stop Souvenirs, Maryland's NASCAR connection.
New cars, used cars, award-winning service, and factory-rated Baltimore's number one Buick dealer for customer satisfaction. That's Miller Motors, the complete dealership where our low overhead means you get the savings. No high-pressure selling, just low prices and old-fashioned courtesy. That's the way it's been since 1932. For your new Buick, make it Miller Motors for selection, savings, service. Conveniently inside Beltway Exit 32A on Bel Air Road.
In South Dallas, folks like to work on their cars, and a lot of them come to AutoZone. They save money on top quality parts, and they find helpful people like Rocky Brown. Oh, sure, there are other parts stores in town, but Rocky's the kind of guy folks go out of their way to see. He's good at solving problems, but he really knows his parts. You see, when it comes to getting the right part, the right price, and good advice, there's just no place better than AutoZone.
On the road again. I just can't wait to get on the road again.
Make a run to your participating General Tire retailer to enter the General Tire Run for the Sun Super Bowl sweepstakes. You could win hundreds of great football prizes or even our grand prize, a trip for two to Super Bowl 30 in sunny Phoenix, Arizona. Hurry in for your chance to win today.
Sooner or later, you'll own Generals.
ESPN Speed World, coverage of the Napa 500, being brought to you by Allied Signals Autolite Spark Plugs, guaranteed for 2 years no matter how far you go. By Smooth Bush Beer and Easy Drinking Bush Light, Bush, the official beer of NASCAR. And by the more than 1,000 AutoZone stores across America. AutoZone, the best parts in auto parts. Let's take a look at how they finished here today. The full field rundown as the celebration of the champion Jeff Gordon continues.
We see Dale Earnhardt the winner. NASCAR has notified Richard Childers. We want your Chevrolet to take to the Lockheed Wind Tunnel along with Ernie Irvin's Ford.
Bobby Hillen had his best finish of the year, finishing in ninth position.
Jimmy Spencer had a great run. We talked to him just a moment ago.
Darrell Waltrip, the pole sitter, ended up in 16th place.
Yeah, had an engine go sour there near the end of the race. So did a lot of other drivers. Morgan Shepherd, you see, winds up in 22nd position there. And Jeff Purvis comes home 26th in the reason for racing car.
And taking a look now at 31 through 42, Dale Jarrett had a bad day losing a cylinder early, and a real bad day for Kenny Schrader.
It's only fitting with the year the Schrader's had that he would finish dead last.
You're absolutely right. There's a championship celebration. When we come back, we'll take a look at the top 25 in points and the bonus money they'll be receiving.
With each race, he faces a new challenge, a fresh shot at the pole, and another chance to win this season's overall prize, the Busch Series Pole Award. Only then will he earn a ride at Daytona, where he'll run with the big boys in the Busch Clash. We're proud to be with him from the first turn to the last. Busch, the official beer of NASCAR.
At AutoZone, most of our customers are the kind of people who like to work on their cars themselves. That way they save money and they know the work's done right. Of course, when they come to AutoZone, they know they're going to find the right part for the right price. But sometimes what they're looking for is just a little advice. And that's okay, because we don't put a price tag on it. You see, at AutoZone, we take pride in taking care of our customers. And we've learned that when you treat folks right, they keep coming back.
Hope you can join us right after the Napa 500 today, a special championship edition of NASCAR Shop Talk here in Atlanta. We'll salute the champion, and you'll see a first look at the championship collectibles. That's following today's Napa 500.
There's a champion, Jeff Gordon. You'll be able to buy some of his new Winston Cup champion paraphernalia here in just a few moments. In the meantime, let's go to John Kernan.
With a very happy Bobby Labonte, I guess happy because, well, you guys rolled the dice at one time, got a lap down, you finished eighth, but the most important thing, number 10 in points.
Well, that's right. You know, the whole Interstate Batteries team, we worked hard all year long, and we made some great decisions throughout the year, won three races, had some top fives, had a couple poles, and got to 10th in points. And, you know, that was a goal of ours at the beginning of the year. So we learned a lot, and, you know, we're looking forward to next year. And, you know, we did gamble a little bit today, and if we'd gone our way, we'd have been in the lead lap at least. But didn't work out, so we were lap down, but we had a really good race car.
Well, that's Bobby Labonte. After a good run today, finishes 10th in the points. Looking forward to next year, Bob.
Congratulations to Bobby Labonte. Great run here today. And as John indicated, finishing 10th in the point standings. That means he's going to be on stage at the Waldorf Astoria on the night of December 1st. Top 25 in points coming up when we come back to Atlanta.
Takes to win the UAW GM Teamwork of Excellence Award. Just ask Dale Earnhardt.
the heck are those guys?
UAWGN, assembly line to finish line, teamwork wins.
If you don't replace your air and oil filters regularly, you might as well drive your car off a cliff. Because dirt can really mess up an engine. Fram Extra Life air filters and Fram Extra Guard oil filters keep out dirt best to protect your engine. Fram, America's number one premium brand. Pay a little now or a lot later.
Buy any two Fram filters and get your favorite officially licensed NFL team cap for $1.99.
AutoZone, most of our customers are folks who like to work on their cars themselves. But the ones who come in most often are those who work on cars for a living. Guys like Ed Graven. Now, Ed's garage is in Ogden, Utah, where most of the time you'll find him pulling an engine or sliding under a car. And just about every day, he drives past a half dozen other parts stores on his way to AutoZone. Because Ed knows that when it comes to getting the right part for the right price, there's just no place better than AutoZone.
Jeff Gordon and members of the Rainbow Warriors making their lap around the racetrack on the big flatbed as everybody is staying around to salute the champion. Now let's take a look at the final point standings. After 31 hard-fought races, Jeff Gordon comes home the champion, going to pick up $1.3 million. Sterling Marlin moved up to third in the point standings, and that means an additional $110,000. That's how much more third pays than fourth.
And once again, this is just the Winston money. There's going to be more to add on to this total.
Bobby Labonte stays in 10th. Bill Elliott moved up to 8th, putting Ricky Rudd back to 9th, and that means an additional $20,000.
And there at 11 through 15, Morgan Shepherd stayed in 11th today. Michael Waltrip moved up a couple spots. Dale Jarrett dropped to one spot. Bobby Hamilton stayed. He's in 14th. And Derek Cope winds up in 15th place.
Taking a look at 16 through 20 final finishers in the point standings. Again, the bonus money is over there on the right. Even the 20th pace driver in the point standings will walk off with a bonus check of $25,000. Now 21 through 25.
Rick Mast, Ward Burton, Lake Speed, Ricky Craven, and Dick Trickle. Dick Trickle gets 25th place money.
Jerry punches with Ricky Rudd.
Well, the race is over now. It's family time. Ricky along with 14-month-old Landon Lee. And Ricky, the winning streak continued last time. We race out at Phoenix, and today another great run for you.
Well, Jerry, it really was. We didn't quite have the staying power with that tight Danny Ford today, but it ran awfully good at different stretches. We got down a lap there, got hung up with some traffic, and Earnhardt was just flying today. But we've had a great year. We're lucky to get back to the top 10 in points, won at Phoenix last week, and we're just really pleased with the season.
You had a car that could run up front most of the day. Now, you lost a lap, and that was sort of a mystery we were trying to figure out because your car was so quick.
Well, we were good at stages, and we kept adjusting the car. We weren't good enough to beat the three, so we said, let's go to work on it. We kept making aerodynamic the front fenders, little tire pressure changes, and every time we did, it seemed like we hurt ourselves. So, and then we get stuck out there running slow till we could make our adjustments back to where we were. So it was a little bit frustrating because we just simply couldn't get the handle on it, but we ended up slowing ourselves down to the point we got lapped one time. So that was a little bit frustrating. We ended up probably had a fifth-place car and ended up 10th.
Well, the fireworks are going off. Ricky Rudd gets 10th today. He finishes 9th in the overall point standings, and now the Rudd family can go home and have some family time. Bob?
Fireworks over past turn number 3 as the flatbed has made its way around the racetrack and is back here at the start-finish line as Jeff Gordon and the others soaks in everything they can because it's a moment he'll long remember.
Jeff was looking at the fireworks and saying, is that for me? Is that really just for me? By the way, Ward Burton said a little bit ago that they were going to go to Daytona and test. That's a manufacturer's test. The race fans understand that the teams cannot test between now and January the 1st at a NASCAR Winston Cup track.
You know, I was at the USAC banquet in 1990 when Jeff Gordon walked off with the midget championship and would later go on to win the Silver Crown championship. Jeff was so emotional that night as he thanked just about everybody in the world to getting him to where he was at that moment. And I think he really believed that he was at the peak of his career then. And now, some 5 years later, he's really at the peak of his career.
I don't know. Because
how many more can he win, right?
How many more can he win? And hey, let's face it, 5 years from now, that money won, the number might be $2.5 million.
That's right.
So,
yeah.
I mean, if you judge things by money, who knows how far you can go?
He has a bright future ahead. I don't think there's any doubt about that.
Well, you know, he's done a lot this year, but there's more ahead, I'm sure. Don't forget, Shop Talk is coming up here in just a few moments as you can buy some of Jeff's championship paraphernalia with Benny and Eli Gold. Don't forget, Winter Heat, a six-race series that is coming up on ESPN2 beginning the first week in December. Benny and I will be in Tucson for all that stock car action featuring the late models in the Southwest Tour and the Winston Cup car, Winston West cars, and also Bill Weber will be with us for that. So we hope you can join us on ESPN2 for Winter Heat coming up. And I think I speak for everybody, at least here in the booth and down the pit area, Ned Jarrett and Benny Parsons and Jerry Punch and John Kernan and Bill Weber for saying it's been a great season for us, but it's not over yet because we'll be at the Waldorf Astoria on December 1st, when we hand out the checks at the Winston Cup Banquet. We salute our ESPN crew members who work so hard to bring you the races. Three regulars, Leo Boucher, Ron Scalise, and Bobby Carter, aren't here this weekend, but we thank you for all of your support. And now, our salute to the champion, Jeff Gordon, at the 95 season.
It's been a long time coming, this feeling like things will always go your way, such a long shot. Been so deep in the hole. Anything can happen, oh, I know that now. Hey, one slip, one fall, turn the head, can't change it all. Step ahead, step behind, a blink of an eye at the wrong time. North, south, east, and west, spin the wheel, hope for the best. No regrets, it's on the road. Put the drivers at the cruise control. Walk tall, and away you go. Wheels roll. Self to blame. Then he smiled at me, finally, oh, I came around. Can't work, never know, so don't beat yourself down. One slip, one fall, turn the head, can't change it all. Step ahead, step behind, a blink of an eye at the wrong time. North, south, east, and west, spin the wheel, hope for the best. No regrets, it's all.
From all of us at ESPN, congratulations to the 1995 NASCAR Winston Cup champion, Jeff Gordon.
Hi, everybody. I'm Eli Gold. Welcome to a special championship edition of NASCAR Shop Talk. I'm joined by a man who knows all about championships, the former Winston Cup titleist, Benny Parsons. And Benny and I are going to spend this next half hour talking about this great 1995 season. And we'll be sharing with you some very special memories, and we'll also be letting you see part of what made this a history-making season for Jeff Gordon. We'll look at some of the items that will be available to you today, some great new collectibles that will mark Jeff Gordon's very first NASCAR Winston Cup championship. Take a look and see what's in store for you on today's show.
Thanks, Eli. You can take part in the history being made here today as we celebrate Jeff Gordon's first Winston Cup championship and pay tribute to defending champion Dale Earnhardt. We have many newly created collectibles for you today, including your choice of the just-made 1995 champion t-shirts and sweatshirts, each combined with a special champion cap. Other great wearables include the authentically styled DuPont uniform jacket, available in both genuine leather or cotton twill. Dale Earnhardt fans can get the same leather jacket designed for the Goodwrench team. Also styled just like the driver's racing suit are these heavyweight cotton crew shirts, available in both DuPont or Goodwrench team colors. We've got a great selection of die-cast to add to your collections from both the 1995 champ Gordon and the seven-time champion Dale Earnhardt, like the number 24 Monte Carlo, this unusual number 3 golf cart bank, or this brand new number 3 Monte Carlo desk set. We also have a special preview offer from Racing Champions for the first 1995 champion die-casts coming up later in the show. But first up today, perhaps the most unique of all the items created for this show is this authentic Jeff Gordon golden thumbprint. Earlier today, right here at the track in Atlanta, Jeff was asked to press his thumb into a plaster cast. We were there to witness the event just like they do in Hollywood. From this cast, a strictly limited number of cultured marble plaques will be made to look like this, featuring Jeff's portrait and stats regarding his new championship. We think it's the best collectible we've seen yet. It'll come to you in a beautifully designed box with certificate of authenticity. Manufacturing begins next week, and the plaques will be ready to ship right after Thanksgiving. Call 1-800-258-1111 to reserve yours now. It's just $49.99. The next item is also just being created. That's the 1995 Jeff Gordon Championship Solid Silver Collector's Coin. This beautifully minted medallion features Jeff's portrait on the front and the 1995 champion logo on the back. Each coin is individually numbered and comes in a special collector's box with certificate of authenticity. It's 1 troy ounce of solid silver and limited to only 5,000. The silver coin is just $39.99. And now let's go back to Eli and his special guest, Benny Parsons, to take a look back at Jeff Gordon's championship season.
We're back, ready to talk racing. And Benito, who would have thought it, that quick of a championship for Jeff Gordon?
Well, maybe the folks at Hendrick Motorsports, maybe the Jeff Gordon fans around the country, but I don't think that 90% of the fans would have thought it, Eli, because only in his third season, Jeff Gordon wins a championship, and Earnhardt had so much going for him, going for that eighth championship.
And I think that's the thing right here. It was a memorable season all around. Sterling Marlins back-to-back repeat at the Daytona 500. Ward Burton got his first win of the year. Mark Martin, a three-peat now at Watkins Glen. What else? Bobby Labonte had a great year. He arrives with 3 victories now, including the first of his season. But I guess the big story has to be Earnhardt, the veteran battling the youngster, Jeff. He was on a mission, no question about it, Jeff Gordon was. It didn't really begin all that well, though. Remember what happened in Daytona? They were behind the eight ball in a hurry.
Jeff Gordon had a very good car in Daytona. He made a pit stop. The car fell off the jack, ruined the left front fender, which ruined the aerodynamics. But they fixed that problem. They come back home from Daytona. They get that new jack man, the same guy they had last year.
Right.
And since then, their pit crew's been awesome.
And, of course, over the next half dozen races, Earnhardt sort of took control at the top of the points. I guess you'd say he took control for a while.
For a while, until Talladega.
Yeah.
And then that was the real turnaround, Talladega.
And by North Wilkesboro, Earnhardt again seemed to be pretty much in control. He had a victory. He'd had the most laps led. He had a pretty firm grip on first place, and Jeff was, I guess, back in third at Wilkesboro time.
At Wilkesboro time. But then Jeff Gordon does well at North Wilkesboro, Martinsville, but then again at Talladega, that was a big turnaround. Mm-hmm. Earnhardt, who ran so well, but had contact on the last lap and finished back in the 20th, he and Jeff Gordon are tied for the points. But Jeff Gordon gets a $100,000 bonus because he has most victories.
You have a mind like a steel trap. I'm impressed, my friend. When we come back, we'll take you to turn two of the season. We'll see how the hunter became the hunted. But first, another look at the fine items we're showing you for the very first time. Some very unusual championship collectibles. Take a look.
That's right, Eli. This thumbprint plaque is the most unusual collectible available today. It's a cast of Jeff Gordon's right thumb preserved forever as a gold mark on a cultured marble plaque with the 1995 champion stats. It comes in a special box with a certificate of authenticity. It's a strictly limited edition, so call now to reserve yours. Just $49.99. Another new and special item today is the solid silver limited edition 1995 champion coin, newly minted to commemorate the championship of Jeff Gordon. The coin is only $39.99. Call 1-800-258-1111 to place your order. Stay tuned. We'll be right back with more Shop Talk after this.
With my itchy dandruff, I said I'd try it. Denerex tingles. Head and Shoulders doesn't.
Both have effective dandruff medicine, but Denerex has something extra that tingles, feels fresh.
That's why I started using Denerex. The flakes, the itch, gone.
Denerex, the serious dandruff shampoo.
Roll into Pep Boys right now and get a full set of four 70,000-mile tires for just $169. That's any size, any four 70,000-mile tires in stock for just $169 at Pep Boys now. Need antifreeze at Pep Boys and Parts USA? We've got this and that and this and that. We have every major brand at everyday low prices, like this for only that. New temp for just $3.99 a gallon after mail-in rebate at all Pep Boys and Parts USA stores now.
A spirit of teamwork. That's what makes the Home Depot proud to be a sponsor of the 1996 Olympic Summer Games and the 96 Paralympic Games. Also proud to have Newell as a member of our Home Depot Olympic family. Since 1903, Newell has brought you drapery hardware, paint applicators, and shelving systems. Striving to be the best is the mark of Newell and of Home Depot, helping to bring the games to America.
Where will you be when your battery decides to die? There's no way of knowing. So if your battery's more than 3 years old, don't chance it. Maybe this is the time to get to Sears and replace it with the one that's America's most trusted, the DieHard battery. Before yours dies, get the DieHard at Sears Auto Center.
My asthma struck as my daughter started crying. It wasn't the time to try some unknown brand. I trust Primatene.
It starts to open clogged breathing passages in as fast as 15 seconds.
She depends on me. I depend on Primatene Mist.
Fastest type asthma relief without a prescription.
Welcome back to Shop Talk. These all-new combos are the perfect way to commemorate Jeff's incredible first NASCAR Winston Cup championship. Choose from this tee design with the Winston Cup trophy or this one with Jeff Gordon on the front and this brand new champion insignia on the back. Also available today is the new 1995 champion sweatshirt, which also has the trophy in the design on the front. Each shirt is paired with a cap specially embroidered with the 1995 champion insignia. The tees are 100% cotton and the sweatshirt is cotton blend for long wearing comfort. The t-shirts and caps are $29.99 each. Ask for the trophy tee combo or the champion tee combo. The trophy sweatshirt and cap is $39.99. All shirts are available in medium to double extra large. The cap, one size fits all. So call now, 1-800-258-1111.
We are back taking you through the 1995 NASCAR Winston Cup season, focusing on the showdown for the championship between Dale Earnhardt and Jeff Gordon. And of course, Jeff Gordon, once we got into the season, Benny, a young driver, more confidence, more success, and obviously success breeds more success.
Well, that's right. He had three victories, some did not finishes, but he gets top fives at Martinsville and at Talladega. And Earnhardt finished out of the top 20. Mm-hmm. They leave Talladega once again. Tied for the points, but Jeff Gordon gets the $100,000 bonus because he has the most victories. And then he goes to Sears Point, a road course where neither one of them really has had success. But Earnhardt wins at the road course. Jeff Gordon finishes third, but Earnhardt retakes the lead again.
So here they are. They're shifting their way through. And I guess that's the operative word, shifting, because we go to Pocono, and shifting or a missed gear shift was a story there for Jeff Gordon.
Man, that was unbelievable. He dominated the race at Pocono, but missed a shift with just a couple laps to go on a restart and finishes 16th instead of first or second where he should have finished.
Not enough credit has been given to Ray Evernham. And yeah, the team had some problems at Charlotte a couple of weeks after that trip to the coast. Ray Evernham was fined $60,000. They had that non-approved hub on the car that broke. And a lot of teams would have cracked right there. Ray Evernham didn't let that young team get off track.
That was unbelievable how they came back from that. All the folks talking about, has Jeff Gordon been cheated? They proved to him at Dover, they went there, sit on the pole. Didn't win the race, sit on the pole. They proved to him, hey, we've been racing legal all year long. With or without the lightweight hubs, we have been where we are today.
And I think you're probably a good guy to address that, even though this is a Jeff Gordon, Dale Earnhardt retrospective. But when you won your championship, I mean, you guys were about as derailed as you could have been in the last race of the season. And you fellas didn't lose your focus either that day.
You can't lose your focus. I crashed on the 13th lap, destroyed a race car, or so I thought. Mm-hmm. But the crew fixed it. I'd get back on the racetrack and go on and win the championship. And that's exactly what Evernham and Jeff Gordon have done. They've stayed focused, and there they win the championship.
Benny Parsons with us. When we come back, we'll remember what happened mid-season. But first, time to take another look at some of the items we're offering to you on today's championship edition of NASCAR Shop Talk.
Thanks, Eli. Choose the design that suits you best in these newly designed 1995 Champion T-shirt or sweatshirt and cap combos. The tees with caps are $29.99. Specify the one you want, either the trophy tee or the champion tee. The trophy sweatshirt with cap is $39.99. So call now, 1-800-258-1111. Stay tuned. We'll be right back with more NASCAR Shop Talk after this.
You can design your own computer system and save money with a little help from PC Warehouse. PC Warehouse specializes in designing and servicing computer systems based on their customer specifications. If you're not sure what configuration you need, our trained technicians will be glad to help. Right now, PC Warehouse is offering great deals on 486DX and Pentium multimedia systems from only $11.95. So for custom-built PC systems and unsurpassed service, call PC Warehouse at 561-7547.
In the market for a new Ford? Now is the time! Due to Plaza Ford's remodeling, they're having a construction sale, and the crew needs more room. Everything must go. Mustangs, F-150s, vans, Explorers, Escorts, take off hundreds, even thousands. Plaza Ford says make them an offer they can't refuse. And get it off their lot! Plaza Ford, go north on Beltway Exit 32, make them an offer, and get it off their lot!
Glenn Jacobs, and I've been a PA here at Sports Center for about 3 months, and it's been really great.
You've embarrassed me on national TV.
I mean, I work long hours, sure, but I get a lot of exercise. I mean, it's really cool when one of those guys reads something I've written on the air.
Nice try, Sparky. Nice try. Maybe next time.
4 months ago, I was writing a paper about my Kilborn.
Gary?
Glenn?
Okay.
Here I am getting career advice from him.
Two words for you. Pizza delivery.
It's incredible.
Welcome back to Shop Talk. Wear the colors of the 1995 champion Jeff Gordon's Rainbow Warriors, Dale Earnhardt's Goodwrench, or Rusty Wallace's Miller Genuine Draft Team with our special selection of uniform jackets and crew shirts. All the jackets are styled just like the racer's own racing uniform, right down to the finely embroidered logos front and back. All three jackets are available in genuine soft leather, fully lined and expertly tailored with front zip, rib knit waist and cuffs, and side pockets. Available in sizes medium to double extra large, these are the same jackets you've seen elsewhere for as much as $1,200. But we're glad we can offer them today at just $399.99. Call now to order yours. Also available is the fine heavyweight cotton twill version of the Gordon jacket. It's styled exactly like the leather version and completely lined. The Gordon uniform jacket in cotton twill is only $149.99. The uniform crew shirts are also designed just like the DuPont and Goodwrench team wear. They're 100% cotton and come in all sizes. Order the DuPont crew shirt only $32.99 or the Goodwrench crew shirt just $29.99. Call now to place your order. 1-800-258-1111. Now back to Eli and Benny Parsons with more NASCAR Shop Talk.
Welcome back, everybody, to a special championship edition of NASCAR Shop Talk. I'm Eli Gold, joined by Benny Parsons, a former NASCAR Winston Cup Series champion. And, Benny, as we headed to the mid-stage of the season, the Michigan run, back to Daytona second time, New Hampshire, Pocono again, what did you think from the DuPont team? Did you really expect that they had what it took inside to win the championship?
I wondered. I think we all wondered if they really had it. But they started picking each other up. We talked about Ray Evernham and the problems he had at Charlotte. They go to Dover the next race and sit on the pole. That tells me the team is coming back. And then we talked about the missed shift at Pocono. I mean, Jeff Gordon lost the race. He admitted he just simply missed a shift. But the team picked him back up. They go to the next race at Michigan. They do well. Daytona. Jeff Gordon wins the Pepsi 400 to be the youngest driver ever to win at Daytona. And then at Loudon, he makes a mistake qualifying. Brushes the wall. He hits the wall at Loudon trying to qualify. They have to start 21st, but the team held together. They win Loudon, take over the points lead again, and once again, to pick up another $100,000 bonus.
Now, about halfway through the season, and Benny, I guess it became clear to a lot of folks that some of those early season mistakes had actually turned into some pretty decent opportunities to learn, and I think Jeff Gordon was very honest. He said, yeah, I messed up at Talladega back in May. He said, I made a mistake here, made a mistake there, and it takes a big guy to admit those kind of mistakes.
Yeah, exactly right, and that's what I'm just talking about. The team just keeps picking Jeff up when he makes mistakes as a young driver is going to do, and every now and mistakes that young crew chiefs are going to do, and the team, they're not that old either, but they're all learning together and doing a heck of a job.
And Ray Everingham himself, a former racer, which certainly can't hurt because he's been in the cockpit of that race car. He can tell Jeff Gordon, if nothing else, keep your cool. I've been there, done that. Don't worry about it.
Ray Everingham, I think, is the key to Jeff Gordon's success. He talks to him on the radio when he feels like that Jeff Gordon is going to get flustered, as all race car drivers do. And Ray Everingham knows that. He just simply pushes that button down and says, Jeff, hang on. We'll get it back. We'll adjust the car. We'll be okay. And Jeff Gordon believes every word that Ray is saying.
And as soon as we come back, it'll be time for us to talk about the show down at the Brickyard, where the man in black went to Jeff's own backyard, flexed some of that good wrench muscle of his, and took himself a victory. But first, we're going to give you another look at all the items we're offering today. And remember, if the phone lines are busy, try again, because the operators are standing by 24 hours a day. So give us a call, and we are coming right back.
Thanks, Eli. You'll look just like a champ in one of these NASCAR driver uniform jackets or crew shirts, styled just like the ones Jeff Gordon, Dale Earnhardt, and Rusty Wallace wear on the track. The jacket's made of the highest quality 100% genuine leather with embroidered logos front and back. It's only $399.99 each. Also available is a heavy cotton twill version of Jeff Gordon's uniform jacket, just $149.99. The crew shirts are 100% cotton. The DuPont crew shirt is only $32.99, and the Goodrich crew shirt just $29.99. Call now to place your order, 1-800-258-1111. Stay tuned. We'll be right back with more Shop Talk.
Roll into Pep Boys right now and get a full set of four 70,000-mile tires for just $169. That's any size, any four 70,000-mile tires in stock for just $169 at Pep Boys now.
From Darlington to Talladega, through Daytona, Rockingham, and Watkins Glen. In every major NASCAR race, Busch Beer recognizes the pole winner with the Busch Pole Award. Because if there's one thing we know for sure, everyone follows the leader. Busch Beer, proud sponsor and official beer of NASCAR.
Need antifreeze at Pep Boys and Parts USA? We've got this and that and this and that. We have every major brand at everyday low prices, like this for only that. New temp for just $3.99 a gallon after mail-in rebate at all Pep Boys and Parts USA stores now.
For me, I played against Reggie Wright, and it was one particular play. I was telling Harris in the car, we ran a sweep around the end, around the corner, and my tight end had him. I mean, I thought he had him. You know, I went around the corner. Next thing you know, I took a hit in my hip. I looked down, it was Reggie Wright. I said, what happened? And my tight end, he looked at me with a solemn face. He said, I flipped.
What, did he trip over somebody?
He saw Reggie Wright, he got scared. Oh.
Welcome back to Shop Talk. No diecast collection can be complete without Jeff Gordon's number 24 Monte Carlo. This limited edition 1/18 scale diecast model is fully detailed inside and out and is complete with movable wheels and hinged hood to reveal the racing engine. As part of Racing Champion's special signature series, this diecast features Jeff Gordon's signature tempo stamped on the bottom of the chassis. The number 24 Monte Carlo is only $49.99. Also today, we have two very unique limited editions for Dale Earnhardt collectors. First, the number 3 golf cart bank is fully detailed with the number 3 on the canopy and sides. The coin slot is hidden behind the seat. This limited edition comes with a certificate of authenticity and is just $29.99. Next, this clever Dale Earnhardt desk set. The beautifully detailed number 3 Monte Carlo is fashioned in shiny silver metal flake and comes displayed on a high-banked base to commemorate the running of the silver anniversary of the 1995 Winston Select at Charlotte Motor Speedway. Gravity holds the car on the display, much like Dale keeps his number 3 on the track at 180 miles an hour. What a great gift for all Earnhardt fans. The desk set bank with car is just $79.99. Please note, this is an adult collectible only. Not available for children under 18. Call now to place your order. 1-800-258-1111. And now back to Eli and Benny Parsons.
We're back, and Benny Parsons, when you look at the season in terms of Dale Earnhardt and Jeff Gordon, particularly the second half of the summer, I think it's kind of interesting. Jeff has the lead, but there was some vintage Dale Earnhardt racing. Try as he could and would, Gordon couldn't quite get rid of that number 3 car.
I think it all started at the Brickyard 400. Mm-hmm. You know, Jeff Gordon won the race last year in his inaugural running, and he sits on the pole this time. Looks like he's going to win his second straight, but Earnhardt comes in and wins the race and showed that he is not dead. He is for real. He's going to try to win that 8th championship. But if we talk about vintage Earnhardt, I think we've got to go to Bristol, Tennessee. I mean, the one of the wildest races of the year, 15 caution flags, a record. Earnhardt taps Rusty Wallace at the beginning. Remember that? And NASCAR puts him at the back of the pack. He charges to the front. Later in the race, he stops for tires, goes to the back of the pack again, and works his way back up and finishes second. So Earnhardt is really and truly trying hard for that 8th championship.
Terry Labonte goes to Victory Lane, maybe one of the worst-looking cars I've ever seen in Victory Lane in my life that day. But I think it was ironic, though. You've got to look, for my money, to the Mountain Dew Southern 500 at Darlington. There have been folks who have waited their entire careers to win there. And I think when Jeff Gordon won at Darlington, at least it showed this one race fan right here, that is team capable of winning a championship.
I think you're exactly right, because Darlington is a very tough racetrack. It's shaped like an egg, and you can wreck there anytime. I was on the pole once and wrecked on the very first lap.
I remember. I was broadcasting that day.
But Jeff Gordon, he stayed there all day long. He got a break later on in the race, got in front, and just drove off from Earnhardt and Rusty Wallace. And I think that convinced us all, Eli, that Jeff Gordon, Ray Evernham, and that crew, they are for real. Mm-hmm. They know what it takes to win, and it looks like they know what it takes to win a championship.
And definitely a lot of converts that afternoon, no question. We're going to come right back with the final chapter on the chase for the 1995 NASCAR Winston Cup Championship. But first, here's another chance for you to own a piece of the championship. Take a look at this.
Thanks, Eli. Take another look at these great gift ideas and unusual collectibles. The 1/18 scale number 24 Monte Carlo is just $49.99. The number 3 golf cart bank is $29.99. And the silver anniversary number 3 Monte Carlo desk set is $79.99. Call now to place your order. 1-800-258-1111. Stay tuned. We've got more NASCAR Shop Talk coming up after this.
Stop at Pep Boys now for our premium brake service. Our ASE certified technicians will install Raybestos lifetime warranty brakes for only $99.99. Get lifetime brakes installed for under $100. Only at Pep Boys. Roll into Pep Boys right now and get a full set of 4 70,000-mile tires for just $169. That's any size, any 4 70,000-mile tires in stock for just $169 at Pep Boys.